Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the Minute Waltz fades away once more, it is my pleasure to introduce the four talented people this week who are going to play Just a Minute. And we welcome Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones, and Clement Freud, and we extend a special welcome to someone who's playing the game for the first time, Maureen Lipman. Would you please welcome all four of them? This is a very special recording of Just a Minute because it actually marks the 25th anniversary of the show. And we've come to Highgate School in North London, and over 25 years, the basic rules have not changed. As ever, I will ask our four panelists to speak, if they can, on the subject that I will give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject on the card. And we begin this anniversary show with Peter Jones. Peter, the subject is jam. Incidentally, for those who don't know, jam is also the nickname for Just a Minute. Peter, 60 seconds, the time starts now.
Yes, the word jam appears in my diary quite often at this time of the year, and it means that I'm coming along to do this marvellous show and not to deviate.
And Derek Nimmo has challenged.
Hesitation, I'm.
Yes, there was a sharp hesitation.
Yeah, a small one, yes.
Right, you have 44 seconds, Derek. You have got a point for a correct challenge. You take over the subject of jam, and the time starts now.
Well, money for old jam is what we actually get for playing Just a Minute, because it is curious that the BBC, in its wisdom, has for so many years kindly paid us to talk absolute rubbish about something we know nothing about. And here we come along.
Clement Freud has challenged.
Repetition of about.
Yes, you did say about twice, Derek.
Well,
you did indeed. You may not have spotted it, but the audience did, and they were laughing.
You certainly didn't.
What's that? Clement, it's a correct challenge. You take over the subject of jam. You have 26 seconds left, starting now.
Jam is a very English three-letter word. It's multi-connotational. Politically, it's in jam tomorrow. Transport-wise, the M25.
He got on the N25 and ground to a halt. Like everybody else. Peter, you challenged. A point for you for a correct challenge. 14 seconds are left. Tell us something more about jam.
So you mustn't deviate or hesitate or repeat yourself or...
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Too many oars. Got too many oars in.
That's what we call a sharp challenge. But as it's correct, I have to be fair, Derek. Yes, it's correct. You have another point and you have 10 seconds on jam starting now.
I particularly like some of the beautifully carved door jams that one sees on fine English house furniture.
And Maureen Lipman has challenged with 1 second ago. Maureen, how clever. You've not played the game before. And you've got him there. In fact, it's only half a second ago, but what is your challenge?
Well, I just wanted to ask a question. Is he allowed to go that slowly?
No.
I think that's a form of hesitation.
Well, normally he gets away with it, but when you challenge, he's not going to get away with it. So, Maureen, you have half a second to tell us something about jam starting now.
Jam?
And Clement Freud has challenged.
Hesitation.
And Maureen Lipman has another point for an incorrect challenge, and she has quarter of a second on jam, starting now.
Jam has got lots of fruit in it.
So at the end of that round, Maureen Lipman, who has never played the game before, is in a commanding lead with 4 points. And she has a singular achievement, too, because she gained them all in under a second. So well done, Maureen. And I think, Maureen, it'd be a lovely idea if you took the second round. The subject is cabinets. Can you tell us something about those in just a minute? You have 60 seconds, starting now.
Cabinets come in many shapes and sizes. I have 2 bedside cabinets by the side of the beds, and they are both right-handed cabinets.
Peter Jones' challenge.
Side of the bed.
Side of the bed.
No, she said bed and bedside, and I think bedside is one word.
Well, the bed's got 2 sides.
No, your bed's got 2 sides. Mine's got one against the wall.
Oh, I see.
Where does Jack fit in?
I would have thought very comfortably. Maureen, that was an incorrect challenge, so you have another point.
Thank you.
You have 53 seconds left on cabinets, starting now.
Right, there are medicine cabinets in which I keep lots of royal jelly, bzz, 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 which keeps me very...
Clement Freud challenged.
The third bzz, I thought, yes, was overdoing it. Yes.
Repetition of bzz.
It's all one bzz, really.
I know, that's the problem of this game. Clement, a correct challenge, a point to you, of course, for being correct. 48 seconds left, cabinets starting now.
Chippendale and Thatcher spring to mind, the first as a constructor and the second as a demolition expert of government. I particularly recommend the latter because she got rid of more cabinet ministers than anybody in her time in Parliament. Where are you now, Norman Tebbit? Well,
Maureen Lipman,
I think there was a hesitation there.
That was a pretty sharp challenge, Maureen. I mean, he was...
He was hesitating.
No. It's what we call teetering on the hesitation. I have to make a judgment, and I think if we got as sharp as that, we would never really get underway. So, Clement, I consider that an incorrect challenge. You have 25 seconds to tell us more about cabinets, starting now.
I don't have any cabinets at home, and I have a number of houses in several different places.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Showing off.
Absolutely true, and thank you for drawing our attention to it. But as the audience enjoyed the challenge so much, but it wasn't correct within just a minute, we give you a bonus point, Derek. But Clement keeps the subject. 18 seconds left, Clement. Cabinets starting now.
We have cardboard boxes in some, and in others, nothing more than a shelf of wood or a piece of material onto which we can put bedside books.
Derek Nimmo,
you're not actually talking about cabinets, you're talking about bits of wood and cardboard boxes.
No. Yeah, yes, it's
no, I'm talking about what I have instead of cabinets.
Yes, instead of cabinets, but I think you have deviated from cabinets onto the bits of wood and the shelves and the cardboard boxes, so I would consider that deviation. Derek, you have a point on the subject and 7 seconds starting now.
In America, the kitchen cabinet, the people actually...
Peter Jones challenged.
First three words, what were they?
I will give you a bonus point, Peter. Ask Derek to start again using the same three words, and the you start...
I'm trying to go quickly, because Maureen was complaining before, that's why.
Well, you start again with the same three words, and you start the clock 1 second later, and Derek's time begins now.
In America, the kitchen cabinet, as it's so-called, are people that actually hold the power.
Peter, challenge, Peter Jones.
It's not quite grammatical, really, to say the people are the cabinet... Ah. He said the cabinet are, you see.
Good challenge.
The cabinet
good
is. Challenge. The cabinet is.
Let's ask the school. I often do this. I do put it to the superior wisdom and judgment of our audience. Now, if you agree with Peter's challenge,
Why do you assume they are superior?
They must be superior to Nicholas.
Yeah. Well, I know. But in his case, it's all right.
I believe in toadying to my audience. So if you agree with Peter's challenge, you cheer for him. If you disagree, you boo for Derek Nimmo. And you all do it together now.
Hooray!
Peter, they entirely agree with you.
They do. Well, that's
yes,
very good.
Entirely agree with you. You have another point and 1 second on cabinet starting now.
My father was a cabinet maker.
That round, let me give you the score. Maureen Lipman's still in the lead with 5 points, and then comes Peter Jones and Derek Nimmo equal in second place, and then Clement 1 point behind them. And Clement, your turn to begin. The subject, getting a break. A rather apt subject. We may discover why they've chosen that for you as you talk on it, starting now.
Well, it does so happen that I broke my left leg some months ago, and if you should get a break, it is terribly important that you should have got it in a reasonably exciting way, because slipping on oxtail soup in the kitchen simply doesn't bear relating. Whenever you walk down the street, people you don't know say, "What happened to you then?" and have no desire to listen to what it is that occurred. So, really, it is unimportant but useful to have broken it parachuting
Maureen Lipman challenged.
Little hesitation there.
Yes, I think we call that one hesitation, Maureen. So you have the subject of getting a break and another point, of course. Correct challenge. You have 27 seconds starting now.
Well, everybody needs a break in their lives, and a good break is to get away on a nice holiday. And everybody... Oh, I've said everybody. I've
yes.
buzzed myself.
Clement Freud challenged you, yes. Clement, the...
To everybody's.
To everybody's, correct. Getting a break is back with you. 21 seconds left, starting now.
Getting a break is also used in the hotel industry for going to places to which you have no desire to go.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
That's right.
Meditation, yes. 13 seconds for you, Derek, on getting a break, starting now.
I got my first break when I joined the tremendous roller skating act Liz, Rayner and Betty. And I used to go on the... It's a very good name of an act, that, actually.
Challenge for pebbles in the mouth.
Yes, there we are. Clement, you pressed your buzzer first.
Yes, it was hesitation.
Yes, I'll give it to you for hesitation. Right, another point, Clement. And 5 seconds on getting a break, starting now.
We had a wonderful break in a hotel in Cornwall.
Derek Nimmo.
Traditional hotel.
No, yes, I said hotels before. I talked about hotels that went in Freud.
That's right, you're quite right. You did say hotels before, mm-hmm. and he said hotel that time.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
yes, that's right. And so an incorrect challenge.
Quite close, though, wasn't it?
Indeed. Clement, you still have the subject. Another point. Getting a break, starting now.
It was on the Tamar overlooking...
Well, at the end of that round, Clement Freud got a number of points. He also got that all-important extra point for speaking as a whistlewind.
Why is it all-important?
Because you haven't worked for it. You just... Well, you have worked for it, I suppose. I don't know, Clement. I just happened to say it.
It's
Why
the
pick
same
me up
importance as the other points.
Just as important as the other points. I just happened to say it. I thought it was a nice phrase. Derek Nimmo didn't complain for once, so I don't see why you want to make a fuss about it. Yes, Maureen?
Waffling.
So, it wasn't an all-important point, but Clement got one for speaking as the whistle went, and he's now in the lead, one ahead of Maureen Lipman, and then comes Derek Nimmo and Peter Jones in that order. And Derek Nimmo, your turn to begin, and the subject is My Lucky Stars. 60 seconds, as usual, starting now.
My Lucky Stars is rather a good subject to have, I think, in just a minute. Astrologers of old thought that one's whole life was predetermined by the conjunction of the stars. For instance, if Uranus was doing something rather curious with Jupiter, that perhaps would bring you tremendous good fortune. People today also read astrology columns in various newspapers to discover what their destiny holds for them on a particular day. Some people, for instance, born in March, are Pisceans, so their sign is a fish, and presumably they'd be happiest if wrapped in newspaper or immersed in water.
Clement Freud has challenged.
Repetition of newspaper.
Yes, because you mentioned the newspaper.
Newspaper and newspapers.
No, you're not going to get away with it.
You say newspapers and wrapped in newspapers.
No, I was listening, Derek.
You said
you said newspaper columns. The plural was on the column.
Didn't mention newspaper. Columns at all.
And no, when you... It, rubbish?
Derek, is he allowed... Sorry, is he allowed to sing it?
You can do whatever he likes,
okay,
actually.
Providing
you bothered about it this time. First it was too slow, then it was too fast, and I'm singing it.
Well, I have to work with you, love, that's the only thing.
Derek, you have another point for an incorrect challenge. You have My Lucky Stars and 18 seconds starting.
Aries, the ram, Cancer, the crab, Virgo, Gemini, and then, of course, we must not forget, because I nearly did, that very interesting star which we all have and never forget, which is one which we call...
Well, Derek Nimmo, you got an extra point for speaking as the whistle went, and you are now equal in the lead with Clement Freud. Peter Jones, we're back with you to start, and the subject is Phantasmagoria. Will you tell us something on that gentle subject, starting now?
Well, it's a kind of mixture of things. You get a sort of effect like Picasso does sometimes. If you could imagine about 14 of Picasso's pictures all jumbled together.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Picasso
came out
twice.
Oh,
yes, of course, yes.
I'm afraid. Derek, you have the subject of Phantasmagoria, and you have 49 seconds, starting now.
I'm not very keen on having Phantasmagoria, because it's a rather complicated subject. It's a collection of images which are not quite... Agoria, of course, means... place, assembly,
Maureen Lipman challenge.
There's a little hesitation there.
There was a little hesitation. We give it to you, Maureen.
I'm ever
we
so
want
sorry.
To hear from you on Phantasmagoria, and 40 seconds are left starting now.
Well, Phantasmagoria, of course, puts one in mind of fantastic and fabulous and all sorts of fabled things like that. Phantasmagoria, the word that's on the card, is something which is really unknown to me, and therefore, whilst I talk about it, I will be talking a tremendous amount of nonsense.
Clement Freud challenged.
I think it's a good time to stop.
Is that all your challenge?
Yes.
Well, in that case, it was incorrect.
Yes.
We'll give you a bonus point because we like the challenge. You could have had her for talking, but she repeated that. But
talking?
Yes,
can't
you repeated
talk?
The word talking twice.
Oh, did I? Oh,
yes,
gosh,
but he didn't have you for that,
talk,
but I thought he
talking.
Might have done. So, Maureen, you have another point for an incorrect challenge. No, you don't. No points are given, because it was...
Anyway, talking nonsense has never been a disadvantage in this particular game.
Maureen, you have 24 seconds to continue with Phantasmagoria starting now.
Well, of course, I do know what Phantasmagoria...
Clement Freud challenged.
That's her second, of course.
It was her second, of course. Isn't that a mean challenge?
But anyway, of course, you were right.
Of course. Clement, you have a point and 22 seconds to tell us something about Phantasmagoria starting now.
The reason why we don't tend to get words like Phantasmagoria in just a minute is because Phantasmagoria has so many syllables that people using it, saying Phantasmagoria, waste a great deal of time and are that much closer to when the whistle blows. That's really what I wanted to say, but...
And you didn't quite get
well,
it.
He's obviously said all he wanted to say, so that
oh, no.
He's going to hesitate, and that's going to be the end of him. So I thought I'd just anticipate a little bit, perhaps precipitate slightly, but he's going to stop, so I was helping him out. Hesitation. Embryonic hesitation.
Clement started to slow down, and he started to have a challenge. I don't know how to judge on that. I think it was an incorrect challenge, Derek, because he didn't actually hesitate. He was slowing down. Clement, you have 2 seconds left on Phantasmagoria, starting now.
Things that go bump in the night would be...
Was speaking then again as the whistle went, gained that extra point. He's now in quite a strong lead ahead of Derek Nimmo. Then comes Maureen Lipman and then Peter Jones. And Maureen, we're back with you to begin. The subject is making up. Will you tell us something about making up in this game, starting now?
I have to make up every night for the theatre, for the play that I'm appearing in with...
Clement Freud, challenge.
Making up every night is repetition.
I know it is. But after 25 years, Clement, I thought you'd know that the repetition in this game means you must not repeat the words. You can be repetitious, but you do not repeat the words. And Maureen Lipman, who's never played it before, knows that, and so she gets a point.
Thank
and she
you
continues
very much.
With 55
happened.
Seconds to go, making up starting now.
So I have to put a lot of makeup on my face in the evening, so therefore during the day I try to keep any sort of makeup off my face. Face.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Two-faced.
Yes.
Oh, Derek. Counter challenge on that.
I agree, but you can't control Derek when he's got a bit between his teeth. Derek, you have a point for a correct challenge. Making up's the subject. 47 seconds are left, starting now.
I have seen Maureen Lipman make up in the evening. It is the most extraordinary sight, because when the daytime one comes off, underneath, there is this extraordinary raddled but beautiful woman, nevertheless. And then it passed on. Pancake, all sorts of rubbish and rouge, and then the wig, and finally she gets out to tumultuous applause because she has made up so wonderfully. And I also make up to her in a professional sense because she is a great star, a stellar body, and I want to keep on the right side of her because she's going to do a play by Neil Simon, and I don't think I'm going to be in it unless I do make up to her. What's the matter now? What's the matter? What's the matter?
I'm going to challenge you on the grounds of schmoozing. That's... And if you say you don't know what it means, you can't be in a Neil Simon play.
Actually, Maureen, you could have him for deviation, because his description of you when you were making up, I thought, was quite erroneous. So you have a point for that, and you have the subject, and you have 5 seconds on making up, starting now.
Making up to...
There is
a real, positive, huge hesitation.
I know the
I've never seen it before at a loss for words.
Absolutely.
It was a great treat. It
and
really
after the things you said about her, I'm not surprised. So, Maureen, I give you another point for that, because... And you have 3 seconds left on making up, starting now.
Making up after a row can be something very, very passionate.
Derek,
very,
Nimmo,
very
chance.
Repetition.
Very, very, yes. Very, Derek, you've got him another point. 1/2 a second to go, making up, starting now.
I like making up very much indeed.
Well, we have an interesting situation at the end of that round because Derek Nimmo is now in the lead, but only 1 point ahead of Clement Freud and Maureen Lipman, equal in second place, and then comes Peter Jones. And Clement, it's your turn to begin, and the subject is laughter. So will you tell us something about laughter in just a minute, starting now?
Mrs. Thatcher was walking down Whitehall and saw a man sitting on the pavement begging, and this would be anathema to her. And as she approached, she noticed a badge around his neck which said, Falkland Veteran. And she was genuinely touched and opened her handbag and gave him £50. And he said, Muchas gracias.
Derek, you challenged.
Well, I suppose that sort of 20 seconds of laughter must constitute a hesitation.
I think so. Yes, I think he should have picked it up. I mean, he really milked that laughter, didn't he? Yes. He never came in at all after, so I have to give it to you, Derek, and say yes. And there are 28 seconds for laughter starting now.
Lord Chesterfield, in his advice to his son, said, a man should only be seen to smile but never heard to laugh. Dean Swift could only remember producing laughter from his own body twice in his life. It is extraordinary that it only became fashionable in after years, during the reign, in fact, of Queen Victoria, a monarch not known greatly for her laughter herself, when Gladstone was taken to task for not having a sense of humour.
Clement challenged as the whistle went. Clement, what's your challenge?
Name dropping.
Well, as their names that Derek seems to be associated with.
Dropping Margaret Thatcher. At least my prime ministers are dead.
We thought they were contemporaries. I'm sorry, Derek.
They are probably to you.
No, Clement, it's not a challenge within the game, so it's a point to Derek Nimmo. 1/2 a second left for you on laughter, Derek, starting now.
I think it is a very good noise.
End of that round, Derek Nimmo getting another point for speaking as the whistle went has increased his lead at the end of the round. And Derek, it's actually your turn to begin. So would you take the subject now of ministers and tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
These are rather curious questions. There are, of course, many kinds of ministers. You can be a minister of religion as well as a political minister. I think, actually, one of the most curious kinds of ministers are the non-conformist ones. Oscar Wilde once said, never make love to a Methodist standing up because it could lead to dancing. And I've always thought this was rather good advice for any minister of religion because it does seem...
Maureen Lipman, a challenge.
Religion, repetition?
Yes.
And he repeated the word religion.
Religion, yes.
Well done,
sure,
Maureen.
He didn't say religions.
Religion.
No, but Maureen's not played the game before, so I'm certainly on her side. Maureen, you have 34 seconds on ministers, starting now.
Ministers come in many shapes and sizes. There was a very famous minister not long ago called Cecil Parkinson, and there was a little joke at the time saying, why is Cecil Parkinson...
Clement Freud challenged.
It's a repetition of Cecil Parkinson.
That's right.
True which enough, just as well. The
Clement,
things that come out of your mind, honestly.
Yes, yes. The subject is ministers. Clement, 24 seconds left, starting now.
When I told my friend Cecil Parkinson that I was going to be on this programme, he said, should the question of ministers come up, I'd be awfully grateful if you would protect me, because my good name is deeply in jeopardy. And I said, of course, I mean, I know what sort of things people are likely to say about you. You can trust me, I said to him.
And Derek Nimmo challenged.
Absolute deviation. No one can trust Clement Freud.
I would have had it for hesitation, because he did almost run down. But no, Clement, I think we can trust you, and so there are 3 seconds left on ministers starting now.
George Brown was probably my favourite minister.
So it's very close out in the lead. Derek just 1 point ahead of Clement Freud, and then Maureen Lipman, and Peter Jones is trailing a little. But Peter, it's your turn to begin. What can you tell us about what's in a sausage? Can you tell us something about that subject in this game? Starting now.
Well, it's really anybody's guess, isn't it? It must have been a brave man who ate the first sausage, I should think, because they are advised to put in a certain amount of bread, I think, but it is limited. Most of it is pork. Various parts of the pig are pushed into this intestine and mixed up. Pepper is quite an important ingredient, I suppose. And I don't know what else. Moist...
A Clement Freud challenge.
Hesitation.
Absolutely.
Yes, yes.
You've never sounded so boring in your life, Peter. I mean,
no,
it's
well,
a boring subject.
It's not a subject that interests me, really. I never eat them.
Why?
I wouldn't eat a sausage, I mean, for anything.
Right. So, Clement, you have the subject of what's in a sausage, and there are 37 seconds left, starting now.
In 3 words, the answer would be not enough meat. According to EC regulations...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Well, I don't really want the subject, obviously, but he's not talking about what's in a sausage. He's talking about what isn't in a sausage. Not enough meat, he said.
Well, challenge, Peter. You have 20 seconds to continue on what's in a sausage, starting now.
I believe you can put venison or even ostrich meat, I heard on the radio, into sausages, as long as they're flavoured with a number of herbs and things. But I don't really advise anybody to try it, because, of course, it's embarrassing to kill an ostrich in cold blood.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Two ostriches.
There's another ostrich.
Oh,
in
yes.
Then. Yes, unfortunately.
Yes. It's true, yes.
So, funny. Derek, yes, you didn't bury your head in the sand enough there, Peter. There are 3 seconds left on what's in a sausage, Derek, starting now.
Cumberland sausages do contain some very interesting ingredients. I like them particularly at Yuletide.
We have no more time to play just a minute, so let me give you the final score. Peter Jones finished in 4th place, then came Maureen Lipman, and then Clement Freud, and just 2 points ahead of him was the man with the most points, so we say he is the winner this week, Derek Nimmo. It only remains for me just to say a special word of thank you to our delightful audience here. You have been helping us to commemorate the 25th anniversary of this show, Just a Minute. And it only remains for me now to say, on behalf of the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, and Anne Ling, who's been keeping the score, and also our producer, Sarah Smith, and also our 4 delightful panellists, and myself, Nicholas Parsons, thank you for listening, and we hope you've enjoyed the show, and we'll be tuned in again next time we take the air and play Just a Minute. Until then, from all of us here, goodbye. Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons. And as the minute waltz fades away once more, it is my pleasure to introduce to you the four exciting and diverse personalities who this week are going to play Just a Minute. We welcome back Derek Nimmo, Wendy Richard, and Paul Merton. And also we welcome for the very first time Stephen Fry. Will you please welcome all four of them? Beside me sits Anne Ling, who is going to keep the score and also blow her whistle when the 60 seconds are up. And as usual, I will ask them to speak if they can without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject, which is on the card in front of me. Let us begin the show this week with Paul Merton. Paul, the subject is what to put on a muffin. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Well, I suppose there's all kinds of things you put on a muffin. You can have butter, jam, or marmalade, or indeed you could put a bicycle on top of a muffin. Anything at all, really. I don't know anything about muffins, and this subject bores me rigid, I'm afraid. But what more can I say about it I haven't said already? I can say lots of other things.
And Derek Nimmo...
Repetition of say.
Yes, what more can I say, and what can I say? Derek got in with a correct challenge, so he gets a point for that, of course. He takes over the subject of what to put on a muffin. There are 40 seconds left, Derek, starting...
A muffin the mule is a charming little quadruped, much seen on children's television, who's now making a comeback. I often like muffin. Terribly funny and amusing and charming, don't you think? Also, what's the matter?
Wendy...
I think that's the wrong sort of muffin. I think you've gone completely off your trolley.
But could you...
It could be any kind of muffin.
It'd be any kind of muffin. I wondered if you could actually understand what he was talking about, could you?
I was trying to put a bit of peace into them.
Yes.
That's the only time I've ever heard you speak quickly. Normally, you string it all out so you can get the 60 seconds.
Well... Wendy, no, I mean, you can take the subject any way you like, and he's decided it must be Muffin the Mule. Derek, you have another point. 30 seconds are left, starting now.
In the 19th century, a muffin was a man who followed young girls. And I suppose, in that case, you would put on to a muffin a policeman to make sure they didn't do anything improper with the ladies that he was pursuing. Onto a muffin, which is like a crumpet, I would put, of course, butter and jam and honey... And all those lovely, gooey things which I enjoy hugely. Muffin the Mule, I would have put on... What's the matter?
And Stephen Fry has challenged.
I think that's our second mule. I think we had one in a previous version when he first talked to us.
Absolutely right.
You've never played the game before, and you very cleverly got in with 1 second to go. So what to put on a muffin is a subject with you, having gained a point, of course, for a correct challenge, and you start now.
Marmalade, of course, is...
End of that round, Stephen was speaking as the whistle went, and whoever does that gets an extra point, so he has 2 points into the round. Derek Nimmo also has 2 points, so they are equal in the lead. And Stephen Fry, will you take the next round? And the subject we've chosen for you is Wilhelm Furtwängler. Can you tell us something about... I'm sure it's been specially chosen for you, but there are 60 seconds to keep going, if you can, starting now.
Well, Wilhelm Furtwängler, as he should probably be pronounced, because there's an umlaut on the A in his name, was a great Germanic conductor of particular...
Oh, yeah. And Derek Nimmo's...
It's been unfair. There were a lot of words.
Yes, there were.
Somebody so bright as he. You should be able to speak something properly.
But he's never played the game before, and I think, really, that was a bit... Stephen, I'm not going to allow that.
Well, you're an old sweetie.
So, because you were interrupted.
Thank you.
And
nobody's ever called him that before.
No. Stephen, you have 49 seconds to continue with the subject. Wilhelm Furtwängler.
Well, Wilhelm Furtwängler was noted chiefly for his interpretations of Wagner, the great German composer of opera and so forth. He performed many times at the Salzburg Festival, where he got quite a reputation. Oh, my God. I'm completely mistaken. Do you know... It's a lot more difficult than it seems when you're listening on the radio. My respect for Paul and Wendy and Derek, which was previously at rock bottom, it's extraordinary. These people are brilliant. I don't know how they do it. Never mind, carry on.
Paul, you challenge first. You have the subject, and there are 36 seconds left. Wilhelm Furtwängler, starting now.
Wilhelm Furtwängler was the winner of the silliest name competition in 1956. He won several years in a row after that, right?
Derek Nimmo challenge.
He won twice.
He won too much. Stephen Fry.
This is impossible because he died in 1954.
yes, but his name lives on.
I think the one you were talking about, the real one, was different to the one Paul was. So, Derek, you had a correct challenge. 26 seconds on Wilhelm Furtwängler, starting now.
I was wandering in this rather seedy part of Hamburg, and this man came up to me and said, my name is Wilhelm Furtwängler, I thought he said. But he said, no, it's Furtwängler. I thought, what an extraordinary thing.
Stephen Judge.
So it was an extraordinary hesitation,
yes,
I thought.
Yeah, extraordinary hesitation, I quite agree. And you have 13 seconds on the subject, starting now.
His interpretation of Tristan and Isolde with Alfred Soothaus as the eponym and... why did I bother?
No, Derek, another point and 8 seconds on the subject, starting now.
I have many records when he was conducting, and I do think they're amongst my most treasured possessions. Unfortunately, I only have them on long play.
Derek Nimmo was then speaking again as the whistle went, gained the extra point, and has moved his lead even further forward. Stephen Fry still in second place, then comes Paul Merton, and then Wendy Richard. Derek, your turn to begin. The subject is wearing spats. Will you tell us something about it in just a minute? You can start now.
Now, wearing spats is a question I would very much like to have because for some considerable time I played in a play called The...
Wendy, Richard Challenge.
Hesitation.
He'd forgotten the name of the play he was in, yes. Wendy, you've got in with a very sharp challenge on wearing spats. 54 seconds are left, starting now.
I think spats are a lovely men's fashion. My father used to wear spats. I think it's very elegant. Apart from that, it also helps you save on shoe polish because you only have to clean the part of your footwear which is showing below and around the spats. They used to come in various colours and you can get several little buttons or just one or two fasteners on the side. As I said before, I've repeated myself.
Derek Nimmo Chant.
Repetition.
Of what?
Self-confessed repetition, as she said before.
As she said before, yes.
I knew.
I have to be sure, because sometimes you challenge just as to bluff one out of it. Derek, correct challenge, 30 seconds, wearing spats, starting now.
Originally, they were part of military wear, and you still see them with the Scottish Regiment. In the summer, they were worn in white canvas, and in the winter months.
Wendy Chance.
I think he's hesitating, you know.
No.
You don't think so?
It was very close. No. No, I don't think that was a
hesitation. One moment I'm going too fast, and the next moment I'm going too slow.
I know. I've got the measure of you now. I know.
For our listeners, Wendy and Derek Nimmo are sitting on one side together, and Derek's now got his arm around Wendy, and Stephen Fry and Paul Merton on the other side.
I haven't got my arm around Paul, but... Yet.
I know people like to have visual images of the people who are performing. 21 seconds for Derek on wearing spats, starting now.
Spats are the spawn.
Paul Merton challenge.
For the people at home who like visual images, I would like to point out that I'm wearing a jumper.
Who are concerned with the sartorial wear of the cast. Nicholas Parsons is in a sports jacket. Wendy is wearing a floral dress with a scarf. Derek Nimmo's in a smart suit with a waistcoat. And, of course, Stephen Fry is wearing dinner jacket. who's challenged?
I made a joke, Nicholas. It's short-term memory. That's your problem. It's difficult, it's sad.
Well, some of your jokes are short-term memory in my case. But it was an interruption, so unfortunately Derek does get a point, and he continues with 20 seconds on wearing spats, starting now.
Spats are the spawns of shellfish, and if one was going to wear them, I suspect they'd better put them on the edge of a hat, rather like Antipodeans wear corks, because they really would be rather niffy. The spats that you wear on your feet...
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of wear.
Yes, you've been wearing
your... Absolutely.
Yes, because wearing is on the card, but wear is not to be repeated. So 6 seconds for you, Paul, on wearing spats, starting now.
My grandfather was a great man for wearing spats. He used to wear them on all sorts of occasions.
Well, Paul Merton was then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point. He's equal to Stephen Fry in second place, Derek Nimmerston in the lead, and Wendy is in fourth place. And your turn to begin, Wendy. The subject, forecasts. Can you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
I never take any notice of weather forecasts because I don't believe they have much accuracy about them at all. I also include in forecasts the horoscopes. Now, just last week, I read mine and it said, you'll be hearing of a large sum of money. The only two letters I received that day, one was an income tax demand for an incredible amount of money, and the other a demand for several more pounds.
Paul Merton challenged.
Unfortunately, repetition of demands.
Yes, they were demanding too much from you, Wendy. And so, Paul's got him with the correct challenge. Another point to him and 36 seconds left on forecasts, Paul, starting now.
There are all kinds of people who try to forecast the weather through amateur means. They hang up seaweed outside their window, or they look at what the cows are doing in the fields. There's all other kinds of...
And Stephen Fry challenge.
Lots of alls and kinds.
Yes, there were indeed, Stephen. Well, listen, 23 seconds for you to tell us something about forecasts, starting now.
Me and my...
Paul Merton challenge.
Hesitation.
Indeed, yes. Oh. 22 seconds for you, Paul, on forecast, starting now.
Hesitation.
Yes, indeed, Derek, a hesitation there. 20 seconds for you to...
Standing in the Blackwater River, which is a tributary of the Bewley, I had to make at least four casts before I hooked my salmon. I was using a collie dog, which is a rather curious fluffy fly, but very effective if you are in that particular water looking for that...
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of water?
Yes.
Blackwater is one word.
That's right, you were Blackwater. Well done, yes, sorry. Bad luck. Well tried, yes. Yeah. 6 seconds for you to continue, Derek, on forecast, starting now.
I never miss the weather forecast on television because of the little funny man on it makes me laugh a great deal.
Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation is a weather forecast on just now and you've missed it. Did you never miss the weather forecast?
Very clever challenge of deviation, Paul. You've got him with 1 second to go on forecast, starting now.
All kinds of betting systems.
Cleverly got back with only 1 second to go, and he's now moved into second place, just ahead of Stephen Fry, and only just 3 points behind Derek Nimmo, and Wendy's still trailing a little. Stephen, it's your turn to begin. The subject is New York.
New York, New York. So good they named it.
Yeah. I was too quick on my buzzer.
You were, actually, because I hadn't actually told him to start.
Oh, hadn't you? Oh, we'll start again.
The subject is New York, and you start now.
New York, New York. So good they named it twice, the old song goes. Of course, people who live in that city have the address twice because... Oh, hell, I said
Wendy,
twice.
Yeah.
I said that because I knew Wendy would get it. That's really good. Pleased.
The chivalrous, I thought. The
chivalrous. Good Lord, the things they say when they don't succeed. 51 seconds for you, Wendy, to take over New York, starting now.
I have never been to New York, but I do look forward to paying a visit there, hopefully, in the new year. I understand.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, I'm afraid. So the thought of going, she hesitated. 45 seconds, Danny, tell us something about New York, starting now.
New York was originally called New Amsterdam, but then it was bought by us, or rather filched by the British, and rechristened New York. Unfortunately, though, one particular area is still named after Dutch family, the...
Stephen Fry challenge.
Oh, did you say named twice, or have I gone to take
no,
him out?
Didn't
what a
say
pity.
Yes, so I did say it twice.
Yes, it was named, that's right. It was New Amsterdam, it was named New Amsterdam.
And... Nick wouldn't have picked it up.
No. No, of course not. No. Sometimes you wonder why I'm here, according to Derek.
Absolutely.
Stephen, you have a correct challenge on 32 seconds on New York, starting now.
I like the Isle of Manhattan, smoke on your pipe and put that in, as one lyricist had it. The great thing about New York, the metropolitan area, is it comprises Staten Island.
Paul.
It's so tense.
Hesitation.
Yes. Ooh, 12 seconds for you to tell us something about New York, starting now.
I want to be a part of it. New York, New York. That is the way the rest of the lyrics go to that particular song that Stephen mentioned earlier. What a wonderful metropolitan city.
Well, Derek is still in the lead. Then comes Paul Merton and then Stephen Fry, and Wendy, surprisingly, is in fourth place. Derek Nimmo, it's your turn to begin. The subject is BBC Radio. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
In the United Kingdom today, we have BBC One
and BBC Two, BBC Three, BBC Four, BBC Five, BBC Radio Nottingham, BBC...
Wendy.
He's listing. Now, we had this out last year, didn't we? We're not doing lists.
But you don't, actually. You have Radio 3 and Radio 4. It's not BBC 3 and BBC 4, so it was deviation, wasn't it?
Yes.
Absolutely right, Wendy. So you have 46 seconds for you to tell us something about BBC Radio, Wendy, starting now.
I have had the good fortune to work for BBC Radio on several occasions. I always enjoy this as I see my dear friend Anne Ling and Nicholas Parsons. A pleasure to see any of them.
Paul Merton Challenge.
I was afraid repetition of C.
It was.
Yes.
What so a hideous brilliant. Sycophancy, I mean.
This is coming good from somebody who called Nicholas Sweetie
say...
earlier.
That's the bare truth. I might say something nice about you, you see. Oh. You don't know.
Yes.
You'll never know now.
Yeah, that's true. Any way to keep going, it doesn't matter. Paul, you had a correct challenge, another point. 34 seconds. BBC Radio starting now.
The BBC Radio Light Entertainment Department has a long and glorious history. If we go back to the 1940s, we can recall such shows as Bandwagon.
Wendy challenged.
That's the only
hesitation.
One I could recall.
Yes, yes, right. 23.
Itmar was the one I was trying to think of.
Oh, yes. And Much Binding in the Marsh.
It's no good to me now, is it, sweetie?
Twenty-three seconds for you, Wendy, on BBC Radio, starting now.
I have done several plays for BBC.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Repetition of Done.
I've only just started.
Last time you said it.
I'm very.
I could have been at home watching the weather forecast.
Wendy, if you really did.
It's all right, sweetie. Sorry. Don't worry. Go on.
Miss Derek, who challenged you?
Oh, go on then. Do right. Another list.
21. 21 seconds, Derek, on BBC Radio, starting now.
The guy writer in charge of BBC Radio is one David Hatch, who was the first person to direct this particular programme many years ago, when he also performed in a very well-known wireless programme, which is called I'm Sorry, I'll Do That Again.
Stephen Fry.
You said direct this programme and then a very well-known wireless programme.
What's wrong with that?
Wireless programme.
Programme, yes, said it twice.
Program.
Too many
I think
programs.
You're allowed to repeat words,
yes.
Derek. I think that's
absolutely,
a clue.
Yes. Too many too many programmes. Right. BBC Radio is with you, Stephen. 8 seconds left, starting now.
Of course, the original Gauleiter of the BBC was David. You're right together.
Imitation.
Yes.
Very bad one.
So he was deviating from his normal voice.
And incoherent, yes. Deviation.
5 seconds for you to tell us something about BBC Radio, starting now.
The ninth...
And Derek Nimmo Chan.
Hesitation.
No. Oh. 4.5 seconds on BBC Radio, Paul, starting now.
The 1950s saw such...
Stephen Fry.
And it's a repetition 19. He was talking about the 1940s earlier.
Yes, you talked about the 1940s for it before. Now you've got the 1950s, so that is repetition 19.
Extraordinary decision, sweetie.
He's a honey puddle, isn't he?
I'll never survive this, I really... There are 2 seconds for you, darling, on BBC Radio, starting now. Stephen.
It used to be a decent institution where words like sweetie...
Right. We're turning into the most theatrical performance of Just a Minute we've ever had. Well, Derek Nimmo's still in the lead, but only one ahead of Paul, and he was only one ahead of Stephen, and Wendy's catching up on the three of them. And Paul Merton, your turn to begin. The subject, deal. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Well, a deal, I suppose, is an arrangement between one or two people, or perhaps even more. For instance, if I was to say to Nicholas Parsons, I will give you £15 for that jacket, that would be a very good deal as far as Nicholas was concerned.
Wendy challenged.
It's two Nicholases.
Mm. Yeah, there are two Nicholases. And you can't have too much of Nicholas, can you? Except in just a minute. So, Wendy, a correct challenge. 42 seconds, starting now.
I enjoy going round antique markets and hopefully get...
And Stephen Fry challenge.
There's a bit of a hesitation now.
I'm afraid it was, yes. Stephen, you have the subject of deal, 37 seconds, starting now.
I think it's a town on the south coast where resides one of my very favourite living authors, Simon Raven, author of the Arms for Oblivion series.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of author.
No, authors and author, I think it was.
Yes, yeah. That's right.
Mm. Oh, right, all right.
Yes.
So, Paul is working for Stephen Fry, and... Stephen, incorrect challenge. You still have the subject of deal. 31 seconds starting now.
A hardwood from a non-renewable source, I believe. Our desks at school were made of deal, and very tough and resilient they were, too. I carved into the deal my initials, S-J-F, and put next to it, I hate Mr. Miller, in very large letters. Deal can take that kind of punishment. Shove on some polish, and there it is. Good as new the very next day. What deal can't take, however, is fire.
Paul, challenge.
Repetition of take.
Yes, oh, yes, he can take it, but he can't take it. Yes. So, Paul, you have a correct challenge. 8 seconds to tell us something about deal, starting now.
I once entered a remarkable deal with a friend of mine. I bet him 15... Ah!
Stephen
Why
Fry.
Why did I say 15?
15 was the sum offered That's ludicrously for your jacket.
You rudely offered for my jacket.
I could have said anything but 15.
Well, that was only because you have a guilty conscience about being so rude about my jacket, you see.
I think it's a good price.
Stephen, you had a correct challenge. You've still got the subject of deal, and you have 2 seconds, that's all, starting now.
Gentlemen, we have a deal, are the words which greet you when you first...
You'll be interested to hear that our first-time player of the game, Stephen Fry, has, with the success he's achieved and the style that he's shown and some of the other phrases that he's come up...
The best term of endearment I ever spent, wasn't it?
Yes.
During this, sweetie.
You've taken the lead ahead of Derek Nimmo and Paul Merton, who are equal in second place, as we come to the last round. And, Wendy, the subject is style. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
Style is something you cannot acquire. You either have it or not. Nicholas has a modicum of style, as one can see by this wonderful jacket that Paul Merton seems determined to give him 15 quid for. Personally, I think he's being slightly overgenerous. But from a distance, the said garment does look all right. I like to think...
Derek Nimmo
has this.
No.
I was drawing for...
Well, your mouth went like a goldfish. I can see your tonsils, you know.
Oh, yes.
You shouldn't have been looking so closely, Derek. Wendy, I disagree with the challenge. You have another point. You have style, and you keep going in style for 38 seconds, if you can, starting now.
Style could also be the way one interprets a role or a piece of music if one is a singer, and, like...
Stephen Fry.
Well, I thought it was a bit of hesitation there.
Yeah, thank you, Stephen.
No, yes, it was a bit of hesitation. So, Stephen, you have 29 seconds to tell us something about style, starting now.
Le style, c'est l'homme, somebody said, French, I expect, meaning the style is the man. There was Das Stil, of course, which was an artistic movement in the early 20th century, also known as neoplasticism, of which Mondrian was a leading proponent. Style, however, is also regarded...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Out of Nicholas Parsons' depth.
You speak for yourself, Derek.
Can you repeat any of that?
Yes, all those neoplasticism of the 18th century and the sobriquet of Le Style. I was listening, actually, for hesitation, repetition and deviation. Now, I won't give you a bonus point for a rotten challenge. I'll just let Stephen have a point for being interrupted. And 15 seconds on style, starting now.
Rather raffish quality of people like Noel Coward is always considered to be an epitome of style of the 20th century. Beau Brummel, perhaps in the 18th and Latin part of the... Latin. Complete drivel.
Yes, yes.
I thought you were going to get him for repetition of the... 18th, 19th.
Really,
seems to work with 19, doesn't it?
6 seconds are left, Derek, for you to tell us something about style, starting now.
I remember helping this old lady over a style, and she was immensely great.
Stephen Fry challenge.
I can see on the card it's written S-T-Y-L-E, not S-T-I-L-E.
Stephen, I had to explain it is how it sounds. We're on radio at the moment.
Homophones are all right, are they?
Oh, yes, yes.
Good.
You took deal as... that's all spelled the same way, but it doesn't matter.
Yes, it is. It's spelled exactly the same way. Fair enough. No. I take your point absolutely. I never spoke.
Yes, it is radio. It's how
it sounds.
I'm
a silly old fool. Pay me no, never mind.
No, no, you've given Derek another point, I'm afraid, and he has 3 seconds to continue in style, starting now.
I picked up my style on the wax tablet and inscribed my name, which was...
Uh,
And Derek, keeping going very cleverly until the whistle went and gaining that all-important extra point for speaking as the whistle went, you have gone 1 point ahead. So let me give you the final score. Wendy, who's done so well in the past, gave us full measure again, but finished in fourth place. Paul Merton, who always gives full value, finished in third place. Stephen Fry, who's not played the game, and he played it like a real sweetie. He really did. And did extraordinarily well. He came only 1 point behind the chap who's got most points, so we call him the winner this week, Derek Nimmo. We do hope that you have enjoyed this edition of Just a Minute and will want to tune in again at the same time next week. It only remains for me to say now, on behalf of our players of the game, Wendy Richard, Derek Nimmo, Stephen Fry and Paul Merton, and Anne Ling, who's been keeping the score, and also the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, and our producer, Sarah Smith, and myself, Nicholas Parsons. Thank you very much for tuning in. We hope you'll be with us again the next time we all play Just a Minute. Bye-bye. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away once more, it's my pleasure to introduce to you the four exciting, different, and exuberant personalities who this week are going to play Just a Minute. We welcome back two long-standing players of the game, Peter Jones and Clement Freud, someone who joined us a few years ago, Paul Merton, and someone who's playing the game for the very first time, Helen Lederer. But would you please welcome all four of them? The rules have remained the same, and I will ask the contestants, our panelists, our players, if they can speak on the subject I give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. We begin the show this week with Peter Jones. Peter, the subject, the boot. Could you try and talk on that for just a minute, starting now?
Well, I suppose that's a rather crude version of getting the sack. I suppose the nicest way to get it is to be invited to submit your resignation. That's what I'd like if I ever am given the boot from this lovely program. I've always been surprised that I haven't had it already, actually. But there you are, the boot, and is sometimes on the other foot. I don't know quite what that means, but I've often heard that expression. Are the buzzers working for the other... Oh, well, they are.
Well, they are working, yes. I think they were being terribly generous to you, actually. You erred.
No, they weren't. They wanted me to flounder on for about 55 seconds, and then somebody would come in and get an extra point. I know what they were doing.
Well, Paul Merton challenged.
I didn't have a challenge. I just wanted to confirm that the buzzers were working.
Yeah. Well, in that case, Paul, it's an incorrect challenge.
I know.
So you get a point.
Ah, good.
And you have 28 seconds to continue telling us something about the boot, starting now.
Well, the boot is also a rock in New Zealand, which juts out into the sea and is roughly the shape of a boot. And it was named after the actual leather article that somebody thought it resembled. And people sometimes go to the toe of the boot and dive into the sea, so other people wash around.
Clement Freud has challenged.
A repetition of people.
Yes, that is right. You did repeat people more than once. Helen, the best way to play the game is to keep your hand on your buzzer all the time, my dear.
I was being polite, Nicholas. I was keeping my hands firmly underneath my legs.
Well, they'll get in.
You're perfectly safe with me.
I know.
Clement, yes, a correct challenge. You have 7 seconds to tell us something about the boot, starting now.
If you put your hand right down to the very bottom of your leg, you find the boot.
Paul Merton challenged.
Deviation, only if you're wearing boots. If you're wearing shoes, you don't find the boot on.
So I think technically that is a form of deviation. So, Paul, you've got a correct challenge, a point for that, and you have cleverly got in with only 2 seconds to go on the boot, starting now.
My dad used to go to this pub called The Boot.
Oh.
Whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gets an extra point, and on this occasion was Paul Merton, who's taken the lead, of course, at the end of the round. Clement Freud, would you take the next round? And the subject is horses. Will you tell us something about that, starting now?
A poet, whose name actually escapes me at the moment, wrote, "I know two things about a horse, and one of them is rather coarse. I know much more than that about horses, because I am passionate about them. I ride, my children do so as well. And I cook."
Paul Merton challenged.
A hesitation?
Yes, definite hesitation, Paul. So you're going to tell us something now about horses, having got another point and 41 seconds left, starting now.
My father was a great gambler on the horses. Although he would often only put down 50 pence at a time, he would regularly bet every day. He would go down to the betting shop, he would walk...
Clement Freud challenged.
Third wood.
He didn't pick you up for two no's in the last time, but anyway, that was a correct challenge, so I have to be fair within the game. 30 seconds are left with Clement Freud on horses, starting now. Peter Jones' challenge.
Hesitation.
So the 29 seconds for you, Peter, on horses, starting now.
I did ride on a horse once only, and the horse made such a dreadful fuss and grumbled and growled and made all kinds of noises. I felt really, if I had been carrying the horse, I couldn't have made more of a to-do.
Clement Freud challenge.
Deviation. The subject is horses. He's only talking about a singular horse. The only thing he's ever ridden.
If the subject is in the plural, you can still take it in the singular, because a singular horse is part of a number of horses.
I may have been going to talk about another horse that I didn't ride.
Peter, another point for an incorrect challenge. 13 seconds, horses starting now.
Now, I would like to be a bareback rider in a circus and mount one of these piebald horses with a lot of things dazzling over my head and a pistol in my right hand.
And Helen Lederer has challenged. Yes, it was hesitation?
It was hesitation, absolutely well spotted.
And you very cleverly got in with half a second to go.
Thanks a lot.
The subject is horses, starting now.
The wonder...
Oh, Paul Merton challenged just before the whistle went. Paul, what's your challenge?
I thought there was a hesitation.
It wasn't a hesitation.
No,
so you have a quarter second to go, and you've got another point for an incorrect challenge as well. Quarter second on horses, starting now.
Beaten the...
Well done. So, Helen was speaking with the whistle. And she's now in the lead with Peter and Paul Merton, and Clement Freud is trailing one behind. Paul, your turn to begin the subject, stains. Could you take that subject and talk on it for just a minute, starting now?
Washing up powders for years have claimed that they can get rid of a variety of stains. Recently, these products have made various...
Helen Lederer challenge.
Hesitation?
Yes, definitely. There are 51 seconds left for you, Helen, to take the subject of stains, starting now.
There are several meanings of the interpretation of the word stains. I feel that Betjeman, of course, referred to stains as a place where bombs should not drop.
Clement Freud?
Wrong.
What was wrong about it?
Come friendly bombs and fall on stains.
Oh, but isn't it near Slough? It's in the same area.
It's in the same area.
Only if indirect
they,
hit.
Only if they
come friendly bombs fall on Slough and stains if you're in that area. That was the rest of the poem, I think.
Yeah. I didn't realise it was quite so pedantic here. So.
I must say, I can think of all the people in India who listen to the programme looking up their maps now of the British Isles.
We've got a lot of confused Indians wandering around stains, wouldn't we? Thinking that they were in Slough.
Clement, a good challenge, and you have 43 seconds to tell us something about stains, starting now.
Stains is quite near Igham, which is a place of which I'm fond, where my daughter went to university at one time. And in 1215, King John signed the Magna Carta on those fields, and there's a small post in a meadow.
Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation. We're talking about Egham now, aren't we?
No.
He signed it at Runnymede. Is Runnymede the same place?
Yep. Exactly where it is.
I've just remembered the rest of the poem. Come friendly bombs fall on Slough, Staines, Igham and Runnymede.
Clement, you have another point and 26 seconds on Staines starting now.
What is quite convenient about Staines is its proximity to London Airport, which is near Isleworth and Hounslow. I would say, much like all people, whatever continent or sub they might come from, to realise the geography of the home counties, which is unparalleled. Staines is...
Peter Jones's challenge.
What does he mean? Come from Europe or sub?
And, continent, he said continents or sub.
Continent or sub.
Yeah, well,
very few people come from sub.
And I think we realised what he was saying. I think it was a clever way of keeping going, don't you?
Not terribly clever.
Anyway,
he's given up the poem. You know, it's out of the window now because you've got to include Isleworth and London Airport as well.
An incorrect challenge. 7 more seconds for you on Staines, starting now.
If you were to ask me how one best gets to Staines, I think either the M4 or Paddington Station Railway.
Wonderful liberal answer, that. He really gives you a choice.
Well, at the end of that round, Clement Freud not in getting an extra point, speaking as the whistle went, he's now in the lead at the end of that round, and Helen Lederer, it's your turn to begin. The subject, fine. Can you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
The rather frightening connotation of the word fine makes me feel almost sick when I recall so many things plopping through my letterbox with pound notes on them, which suggests falsely, I sometimes offer to the police constable that I have been in the bus lane when I shouldn't have been, and also have parked on those horrible zigzags outside a chemist on an alarming Sunday morning. This is not the case, as I said to the PC. Of course, it was a woman, and the more people, not that I'm being sexist by mistake there, of course, that was an additional addenda to what I'm originally saying, which is, of course, as many people as you can book on the zigzags, you get posted to Brigadier, possibly overseas.
I thought I'd give her the opportunity to breathe.
Paul, we will give you a bonus point because we enjoyed the challenge. But as you interrupted Helen, she gets a point for that, and she continues for 22 seconds, if she can, starting now.
It is a wonderful thing to be able to breathe when referring to the fine aspect of our society at the moment. Not the weather aspect, because...
Clement Freud challenge.
Two aspects.
The two aspects, yes. Clement, there are 13 seconds to tell something about fine, starting now.
I had a constituent some years ago who stuck Green Shield stamps on his national health insurance form. And when he came before the magistrates, he was fined... Or allowed...
challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes.
Can I just tell you how that story finished?
Yes.
The magistrate said, you're either fined £50 or have a chromium-plated kettle. Didn't go very well.
No. You're rather good. Regretting it. You told me the story.
Not as Peter Jones has mentioned before, a good medium for... No. Telling jokes.
It needs a couple of weeks on tour, really, first.
Before I think you should have worked it in somewhere before an audience. Paul, we're back with the subject of fine, and you have half a second to go on that, starting now.
My dad used to live...
At the end of that round, Clement Freud is still in the lead, 1 point ahead of Paul Merton, then comes Helen Lederer, and then Peter Jones, and Peter, your turn to begin. The subject is... Subjects. Can you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Well, we're all subject in this country. I don't really like that term myself. I'd prefer to be called a citizen, as the people are in America. And the sooner that happens in this little country, I've said that before. What?
Helen Lederer challenged you.
A hesitation and repetition. Are you allowed to do two?
No, you don't have to rub it in.
You can't have 2 points.
I'll go for the hesitation.
Well, yes, he definitely hesitated, Helen. 44 seconds for you, Helen, on subjects, starting now.
When I was at school, we were forced to take as many subjects as we possibly could. Unfortunately, if you were slightly less intelligent than other people, you were put in lower streams and sometimes forbidden to take even biology.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
She did repeat sometimes.
Yes, she did repeat sometimes. Yes, and Peter, you listen well. You've got it back in with the subject of subjects. And there are 32 seconds left, starting now.
I wasn't very good at any particular subjects, and I remember sitting through homework with the whole school sitting round desks, and I used to time how long I could hold my breath by watching the sweep hand of my watch. And fortunately, this little hobby, that's what it was, made my lungs weak, and eventually they were so bad that I was able to leave school altogether.
That Paul Merton challenge.
A repetition of school.
Yes, you did mention school. You also repeated sitting, but nobody picked you up on that. So they've been quite generous, Peter.
Are they?
6 seconds. On subjects. Paul Merton, starting now.
I think one of my favourite subjects at school, without any shadow of a doubt, was woodwork. What a wonder.
So Peter's weakness kept him going, and he's now equal with Helen Lederer in third place, behind Clement Freud, 1 point ahead, and then comes Paul Merton, 1 ahead in the lead. And Paul, your turn to begin. The subject, builders. Will you tell us something about those chaps in this game, starting now?
I've got some builders round into the house that I've just moved into. They've been doing all kinds of...
Helen Lederer challenge.
Were there two inters?
But he's only been going for 5 seconds.
Oh, is that not done?
It's a bit kind of niggly, that's how we do it. I don't want to embarrass you or anything, but that's how we feel.
Well, I'm...
So you tell us something about builders, Helen, in 55 seconds, if you can, starting now.
Well, the zealousness about interrupting builders can often lead to disaster, as I discovered when I offered them a cup of tea. They interpreted that as something more. They wanted to drink the tea near my bathroom on...
Clement Freud challenged.
2 teas.
Yes, that's right.
Interpreted... I only did that on purpose so that people would like me again for being...
You might have gone a bit too far and telling us what else they asked for after the tea.
Just a piece of cake, probably.
Clement, you have 42 seconds on builders, starting now.
42 seconds is quite a long time to have on builders. I have seldom met builders who've achieved anything in under 3 weeks. It is a portmanteau name for all sorts of jobbing people who do plastering, decorating, painting, as well as building, brickwork, plumbing, and so on. Builders tend to push little cards through your letterbox saying, look no further, the best is not necessarily the most expensive.
Paul Merton challenged.
I think this is deviation, because builders put through cards saying, look no further. Yeah. On the card it says, look no further, but the builder doesn't say, look no further, as he puts the card through. The desperation I've been to, Nick.
Yeah. I'd like him to have the subject.
Yeah.
No.
12 seconds to go, starting now.
I had some builders come round to knock down the Anderson shelter that was in the back garden. It took the two of them several hours to actually penetrate the shell of this aforementioned construction. This was something that...
So Paul Merton was speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point, and he's now taken the lead again, just ahead of Clement Freud, then Helen Lederer, and then Peter Jones in that order. And for people listening who don't know what an Anderson shelter is, they were what we built during the war to protect ourselves. We're pleased to help. They were well built, and they took so long to smash it down.
Well, a bomb probably would have smashed it quite easily. Pneumatic drill takes forever.
Oh,
if the Nazis had parachuted in with pneumatic drills, it would have been fine.
But there's the awful thing in bombing that you get the shrapnel and you get the debris and you get... And Peter Jones challenged.
Well, I thought that we'd be running into the news if we went on it.
I throw out little things like that, hoping that you'll pick them up and come back with one of your quips.
Yeah, well, I'm sorry I couldn't.
All right, Peter, we'll get on with the show. Helen Lederer's turn to begin. And it's a leg pull. 60 seconds as usual, Helen, starting now.
A leg pull is a term that puts people off other people, but I always enjoyed a joke.
Peter Jones' challenge.
A repetition of people, yes. Almost immediately.
Yes, it's... As you got into the first 5 seconds on someone else, we'll let Peter have it on first 5 seconds with you. And there are 55 seconds now for Peter to take over the subject of leg pull, starting now.
Well, a leg pull is a joke at the expense of the owner of the leg. He doesn't get much fun out of it, as a rule, only when all is revealed at the end. And so I don't really enjoy them very much, even if I am pulling the limb. But if I'm not, then it's rather boring.
Clement Freud challenge.
I think hesitation.
35 seconds for you to tell us something about a leg pull, starting now.
One of the very best leg pulls I encountered was on the Victoria line, leaving Manor Park Station, making towards Newbury Park and out into Essex. And there, a man who normally used the buses in order to get back into the city did the following thing to a woman whose address was Gants Hill. He said to her, "If you will climb up onto the fourth floor of this building, open the window and throw yourself out, I will catch you." And she said, "Thank you very much, that's really decent of you. Any moment now the whistle will blow," she said. But nothing happened, because...
You have such a clever, deceptive way of playing the game, Clement. Yes, there was no story at all. You were sort of creating it as you went along. But actually, at 60 seconds, you were still talking, so you do get the bonus point for speaking then, and you are now equal in the lead with Paul Merton at the end of that round, and equal in second place is Peter and Helen. And we now move on to Peter Jones, to your turn to begin. Getting frantic, something we don't actually associate with you, Peter, certainly in just a minute, but can you talk on the subject starting now?
No, it's something that I really associate with the late and much-loved Kenneth Williams. He would have done a very good minute or more even on being frantic and would have actually probably got very frantic in a very entertaining manner. But it's something that I'm, on the whole, try not to do. Because it only upsets the other.
Helen Lederer has a challenge.
Sorry to challenge, I feel so ashamed. Was that a...
Okay, there were four hesitations, he said four
yeah,
times.
That was it.
Yeah. I was beginning to count them and I thought, when is somebody going to come in?
That was repetition.
It's a good opinion for repetition of yes. But well said, Clement. 40 seconds for you, Helen, to tell us something about getting frantic, starting now.
The trouble with getting frantic is it tends to impede your natural potential, which we are all after in this struggling world. It also puts people on edge because they are not calmed by an inner self, which, holistically speaking, is a pursuit we should all endeavour to adopt. Looking around at the people in this room...
Paul Merton challenged.
Repetition of people.
Paul, you've got him with 18 seconds on getting frantic, starting now.
I remember getting very frantic when I was studying my A-level exams. I would do a certain amount of revision in the library, then I have these terrible nightmares that somehow I'd be asked a question that I hadn't properly studied. I remember thinking about this during my history A-level.
Someone challenged, but no light came on.
Me.
Right. I assume it was. Anyway, Clement, yes?
A-level.
A-level, yes. You repeated A-level, and Clement's got him with 1 second to go. Getting frantic, starting now.
Do not get frantic.
Well, at the end of that round, a very close contest. Clement Freud is now 1 point ahead of Paul Merton. Clement, your turn to begin. Nuisances, would you tell us something about that subject in just a minute, starting now?
There are, of course, a huge number of nuisances about us in life. But what I find most irritating are doors that do not open, both ends, in and out, push and pull. It is quite inconceivable that you should have an entry or exit to a building in which some of the means whereby egress or in...
Peter Jones challenge.
Hesitation.
37 seconds, Peter, to tell us something about nuisances, starting now.
I agree with that about the doors, but of course, if you're running a jeweler's shop, You don't want people to be able to rush out terribly quickly, so you make it possible only for them to people to go in or pull the door, which
Paul Merton challenge.
Was it a repetition of people?
It was a repetition of people. So, Paul, 24 seconds for you to tell us something about nuisances, starting now.
The man who lives on across the other side of the road from me is a complete nuisance. He gets up at 5:30 in the morning, starts playing the bagpipes extremely loudly. When I've woken up, he then decides to go out to his back garden...
Peter Jones' challenge.
The repetition of decides.
Yes, he decided twice, didn't he? Yes, bad luck. But Peter got in on 14 seconds. Nuisances starting now.
I hate to say it, but damn animals.
Paul...
Then don't say it.
I feel it's my duty on behalf of my neighbours.
Right. But an incorrect challenge, Peter. So 12 seconds on nuisances starting now.
Well, it's these dogs who foul the pavements. And they do it in such enormous quantities that it's really quite upsetting. I live quite near the zoo. And I think sometimes...
challenged.
What?
Yes, too quite.
Oh, yes, quite. What a pity.
It's only enormous dogs that do the enormous quantities.
Well, I don't know. I was going to say that we live very near the zoo, and I sometimes think that some larger animals escape from the zoo as soon as twilight falls, things like hyenas or even possibly camels or something, and they do their business outside our front door, and then they make their way back to the zoo before dawn. That's my theory. I can't think of any other explanation for it.
You should have said all that in just a minute, Peter. It was delightful.
Well, I was going to, only that pool pressed on.
So Clement did get in before that, and 1/2 second nuisances starting now.
What I find today...
And we begin the last round, so it's still anybody's contest... Paul, it's your turn to begin. Foolishness is the subject. Will you tell us something about it in 60 seconds, if you can, starting now?
There are certain television programmes which try to find their entertainment by making fools of other people. One such particular type of show is the Jeremy Beadle television experience, where he will set up all kinds of practical jokes which unsuspecting members of the audience will then fall for. The type of thing, for example, is where some...
Helen, Lederer challenged.
Types of jokes and type of thing.
That's right, Helen. Well listened, yes. 39 seconds are left, starting now.
There isn't much to offer foolishness, really. The main thing is to be sensible at all times, with a lot of character-building preparation before you go out when people look in the mirror.
Paul Merton challenged.
Well, deviation from the English language. We're all over the place there a bit, I'm afraid.
Yes, looking as they go out, they look in the mirror. Yes, Paul, I think it was a deviation from grammar, so we give it to you. 27 seconds on foolishness, starting now.
And then somebody finds that their car's been blown up, and then comes this bearded fool who springs out of the darkness disguised as some kind of traffic warden and says, "Ah, you've been on my show."
Peter Jones' challenge.
A repetition of show.
Yes, a Jeremy Beadle show, yes.
The lights didn't go on.
Yes, Peter's light came on.
Uh-huh. Have I won on a technicality?
As it's the last round and there's 15 seconds to go and you're actually in the lead, and Peter Jones, I don't think, can win, and foolishness...
God, now he tells me. All the heart goes out of me. That's it. I can't win whatever I do.
Well, there are 15 seconds for you, Peter, to tell us something about foolishness starting now.
Well, sometimes foolishness is reinterpreted years later, and the person who perpetrated it is announced as a genius because they think that something he did or invented possibly or
and
wrote...
That's Clement Freud challenged because the light didn't come on. Yes.
It's a repetition of something.
Then you did say something.
You mean every time a light doesn't come on, it's Clement. Moving the goalpost.
Listen, I've got to keep my wits about me up here. The other three lights are working and Clement's isn't, so if the buzzer goes, it must be Clement.
Well, I'd like to sit there next time. He can't lose, in other words, can he?
No, he can't lose.
He can't lose, no.
No, and he's got 3 seconds to tell us something about foolishness, starting now.
In As You Like It, Shakespeare, who knew nothing about Just a Minute, said... Yeah.
Right. But I said a few moments ago, this was to be the last round, and at the end of that round, I will give you the final score. Helen Lederer, who's never played the game before, but she finished in fourth place, but only 2 points behind Peter Jones, who always contributes a great deal. Paul Merton always gives tremendous value in the show, and Clement Freud, who's played the game many times, but just edged ahead, so with more points, we say, this week, he is our winner. I hope you've enjoyed this edition of our game, and it only remains me to say, on behalf of the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, Anne Ling, who sits beside me, our producer, Sarah Smith, and of course our four very talented players of the game, Helen Lederer, Peter Jones, Paul Merton, Clement Freud, and myself, Nicholas Parsons, thank you for tuning in, and we hope that you'll want to tune in again the same time when we take to the air and play Just a Minute. Until then, from all of us here, goodbye. To Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away once more, it's my pleasure to introduce to you the four diverse personalities who this week are going to play Just a Minute. We welcome back four of our longest players of the game, that is Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones and Clement Freud, and also someone who's been playing it now with great success for a number of years, Wendy Richard. Will you please welcome all four of them? Beside me sits Anne Ling to keep the score and blow her whistle when the 60 seconds are up. And as usual, I'm going to ask our four players of the game to speak on the subject that I give them without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject on the card in front of me. And we'll begin the show this week with Derek Nimmo. Derek, the subject, this and that. Can you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Rather nice, sort of open subject, this and that. I like going, for instance, to Founder's Day at Chelsea Hospital when the statue of Charles II is covered with oak leaves and everybody lines up and all the soldiers walk past and salute the only time when it's allowed with the left hand. That's a terribly moving to the boys of the old brigade. Or perhaps to go to luncheon there after matins when you're given the carrot and the occasional tea to taste.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Is this strictly adhering to the subject of this and that?
That is the most difficult decision I've had to make for a very long time. I would say it wasn't, because he was being very specific about the Chelsea Hospital. So you have a point for a correct challenge, and you take over the subject of this and that, starting now.
Well, it's a sort of vague and indecisive remark.
Can you call it stunning?
What?
Yes, it was. It was sort of vague and indecisive, and you were utterly indecisive.
Yes, actually, I was.
Hesitation.
Yes.
So, Clement, you have a correct challenge and another point, and you have 31 seconds which are left to talk about this and that, starting now.
This and that is pretty well what most political parties stand for. You will go to the hustings and hear them say, vote for us and you will get this and that. Also, the square root, the logarithmic value, plus and minus, the game of two halves. No one was particularly interested. Or to put it another way, the sum of the square of the other two sides. And I can't object to any of those statements because this and that being an open.
So Clement Freud most successfully kept going on this and that until the whistle went. And whoever is speaking at that moment gets an extra point, and it was, of course, Clement Freud. And nobody spotted there were two squares in his speech. But, Clement, you're in the lead at the end of the first round.
But old Parsons' clever dick did.
As
as chairman, I have to concentrate, and you might be surprised to discover I actually get letters from people who spotted listening at home and say you didn't pull him up for that. But when you
there can't be people with a full-time job either. Waste of time writing letters to chairman of panel game thing. I mean, what a ridiculous way to pass the time.
Depends on the chairman, perhaps, Peter.
Absolutely.
Yes. Yeah. All right, we press on. Wendy Richard, your turn to begin. The subject, taking sides. Will you tell us something about that subject in just a minute, starting now?
When I am taking sides, I usually tend to go for the underdog. I always try to help as much as I possibly can, which is why I let Clement say whatever it was he repeated. What?
Well, Clement Freud challenge.
You're doing that to me again. I was just going to say something nice about you.
Clement, what was your challenge?
Hesitation.
No, I don't think she hesitated.
Now.
I'll give you the benefit of the doubt. It wasn't hesitation. You have a point for an incorrect challenge, and you continue on taking sides. 48 seconds, starting now.
Well, after that, I'm not taking sides with Clement at all.
Clement's got the challenge.
Reputation of Clement. Yes.
The listeners, you were still here, as if we could possibly forget.
That was a correct challenge, so Clement, there are now 44 seconds left. Taking sides, starting now.
If you take three sides of smoked salmon and stuff them with a mixture of shrimp, prawn, octopus, horse, cow, lamb.
Wendy Richard,
he's
a chance.
He's listening again.
I know he's listening.
He always does it. He starts doing this.
Well, what is your challenge on the rules
because,
of just a minute?
Well, it should be deviation, hesitation, and repetition and list, because he does it.
Yes, I agree with that. Yes.
Well, you've got to keep going somehow. So, Clement, the subject is still taking sides, and you have 30 seconds starting now.
I always try and keep Wendy Richard on my side because she's such an immensely agreeable, warm, talented, and comfortable person to whom to sit near. And if you take one side of beef and marinate it for 23 minutes, there's no reason at all why, if you boiled it or perhaps poached, would be in a more suitable way.
Peter Jones, a chump.
He mentioned beef earlier. In that list.
No,
he didn't. No, he didn't. It was a long list, but the beef wasn't mentioned.
Wasn't it?
No, I'm sorry, Peter. No, I didn't. And Clement, there are still 5 seconds for you to tell us more about taking sides, starting now.
You can take the side of a house and push very hard indeed, and it may easily fall over.
So Clement Freud was again speaking as a whistle, Wendy gained that extra point and has increased his lead at the end of that round. And it's Peter's turn to begin. Peter, the subject is change. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
Well, change is something we've all got to get used to, and the older we get, the more difficult it becomes. The names of African countries change all the time, as does the cabinet, for instance, and the money changes.
Wendy Richard, chance.
Well, I think there was a slight hesitation.
Yes,
there.
I think
very slight.
One,
yes. Wonderful hearing. I do congratulate you. I think it's amazing, really, for a woman of her age.
You get no quarter here, I'm afraid, Wendy. Mm. But you've got a point for a correct challenge, which is important in this show, and you have 45 seconds to tell us something about change, starting now.
I hate change, and I especially dislike the way they are changing our money. Those new little coins, which are neither use nor ornament, and their 5p pieces are very easy to misplace.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Hesitation.
Hesitation, yes. Yes, or repetition and miss. 30 seconds, Derek, for you to tell us something about change, starting now.
Well, I suppose the nicest kind of change that I like listening to is that of the campanologist. Now, in the tower, my local church in Eastern Morton, Northamptonshire, we have 6 bells working now. And the number of variations of change you can get with the permutating the one night at six. So Wendy got in first. Hesitation, Wendy, 14 seconds left. Change starting now.
I hate change in buildings.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Two hates.
You said I hate before, yes.
Oh, crumb, I keep forgetting.
So Derek's got back very rapidly. 11 seconds on change, Derek, starting now.
I suppose one of the people who changed most frequently was the rector of that seaside hamlet where the Michel Roux has his splendid restaurant now. And through the rain...
Right, so at the end of that round, Derek Nimmo, speaking as a whistle, Wendy got her extra point. He's moved forward in second place alongside Wendy Richard. Clement Freud's still in the lead, and then it's Peter Jones and Clement Freud. It is your turn to begin. The subject, red tape. Well, having been in Parliament, I'm sure you've got some experience with that. But can you talk on the subject starting now?
I think red tape was one of Sitting Bull's sons. The others were called Heliotrope Dick, Paul John, and I'm not really certain. It's odd thing how these Indian chieftains never seem to have thought.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Ace, I can't believe someone was called Heliotrope Dick. Whatever his inadequacy.
I think it was a wonderful flight of fantasy, and I'm inclined to agree with Derek.
What's the challenge?
The challenge was deviation. And, Derek, you have 44 seconds to tell us something about red tape, starting now.
Red tape was actually tied around government documents and then became known as that which stopped the easy flow of exchange of information that prevented you from doing things because of red tape. So that's sort of how we use it for now. And I think if you go along to any kind of office, people by civil servants, you will come up across red tape. They're intensive things.
Peter Jones' challenge.
You're not quite right. You come up across. I mean, not quite right.
I think that's just deviation from grammar, isn't it?
I think
you
it is.
You can't
yes.
come up across.
No, I don't know.
I didn't quite agree.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, Peter, you spotted it. Red tape is with you now. 22 seconds are left, starting now.
Red tape is usually actually pink. It isn't heliotrope or even red. It's a shade lighter than surprise, whatever it is.
Very challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, no, Derek, no. Another point to you. And 11 seconds are left for red tape, starting now.
At Yuletide, I buy great quantities of red tape to tie around the parcels that I put underneath the tree, waiting for the great day when the presents will be unwrapped in front of all my family.
So Derek Nimmo kept going till the whistle went, and has moved forward with another point for speaking at the end, and he's now equal with Clement Freud in the lead. Derek, it's your turn to begin, and it's list. I didn't know this was coming up after your challenge. So the subject is list, Derek. A minute as usual, starting now.
Frank Liszt was born in Hungary in the early 19th century and achieved tremendous renown as a child prodigy. At 9 years old, he came to Great Britain no less than four times when he fell under the influence of Paganini, which is surprising because he's a violinist, but he thought he wanted to be to the piano.
Wendy Richard Jones.
Hesitation.
Oh, no, I think that was a bit sharp. He was sort of... He could keep going. It was a... You're on her side, aren't you?
He was struggling there, I'm telling you.
He was definitely struggling. I always try to be fair, and for a man who was struggling, I thought he only just sort of stumbled, but didn't really hesitate.
So much for sticking up for the underdog.
I know. All right, I'll put it to the audience. You want Wendy to have it, don't you?
Yay!
I'm sorry, there's a lot of prejudice here.
But you're supposed to be impartial.
I am impartial, yes. I've given you the benefit
of the doubt. Why do you listen to mob rule?
Because it's fun on occasion.
Is it?
Derek, I give you the benefit of the doubt because I will just abide by my original decision. It wasn't hesitation. You have another point. Have 43 seconds. List starting now.
Carrots, potatoes, peas, cabbage, sprouts, onions, leeks, sugar, water, catch, all kinds of things you can put together in a list to annoy Wendy Richardson.
It does
frightfully well. I once went out in a rowing boat with Cyril Smith and he
sat on the right-hand side of the boat, and we listened to the starboard. What's the matter?
Who's this?
That was Helen. Yes, Clement, you have another point. And 23 seconds to tell us something about Liszt, starting now.
I quite often drove Phil Smith from the House of Commons to the station in order that he could catch a train to Rochdale, which was his constituency. And the car did Liszt.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Isn't it still his constituency?
Yes, but when he was driving him, it was still his constituency.
When it was his constituency?
It was then when he was driving him, and still
I
is.
Oh,
Clement, an incorrect challenge, so a point to you for that, and 10 seconds left for Liszt, starting now.
Liszt is really a very good subject for just a minute, because most of the time when we are at a loss as to what to say, we think of one word which has a similar meaning to another.
Herman Freud got another, well, a number of points in the round, but one for speaking as the whistle went, and he's now gone back into the lead. And Wendy, it is your turn to begin. The subject, burglar alarms. Will you tell us something about those in this game, starting now?
I'm not very good at dealing with our burglar alarm. Sometimes I forget it's on, rush into the house because I want to get to the bathroom or somewhere else in a hurry, forget that it's... Oh, what?
Derek, you challenge.
Is it repetition and eventually hesitation because he sort of collapsed?
Which one are you going to go for?
I'll go for repetition because that was the first.
All right. 48 seconds for you on burglar alarms. Derek, starting...
I had this company called Modern Alarms who came to fix my burglar alarm, and they went around the house wanting to put in pads, and they said they wanted to put one of these things in front of the chimneypiece. And I said, who are you expecting Father Christmas? I thought it was most ludicrous. Now, when we get into the house now, I have to turn keys and locks...
Clement Freud, challenge.
Repetition, two houses.
I mean, I know you show off and talk about your houses sometimes, but on this occasion... You did mention the house. So, Clement, correct challenge, 33 seconds. Burglar alarm starting now.
The surprising thing about burglar alarms is they never seem to work. When I go home down Wimpole Street, there's sometimes three or four burglar alarms all going at the same time. And
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Well, sure, that proves that they're working.
A nice challenge of deviation, Peter. You have the subject. Another point, of course. 21 seconds. Burglar alarm starting now.
I'm not sure that people pay a great deal of attention to the sound they make. And my idea of burgling would be to go to a house and just activate the alarm system and then dash off to a house nearby. And a crowd would get round the place where the bell was ringing and you'd be free to go...
Oh, half a second ago, Derek, you got in.
A hesitation, I'm
there afraid. Was a hesitation, yeah. I think he hesitated because he realised that the awful thought he was putting into criminal minds.
Yeah, that's right, it was. Felt guilty, really.
Yes. Half a second, Derek, on burglar alarms starting now.
Mine is connected to the police station.
A very funny story about burglar alarms. We've got one... my little cottage in the country, and they were filming this show that's just been out on television, and I'd been very keen to get a part in it, and they didn't want me, they wanted another actor. And in the middle of the filming in the village, my alarm went off, and it's never gone off before, and everybody thinks I did it deliberately and I wasn't even there. Clement, yes?
Deviation. Not a funny story, I think.
It's a very tragic story, really, isn't it?
Very sad, yes.
All right, give Clement a bonus point.
Do you want to talk about any of your other houses?
Right, Clement Freud is 1 point ahead of Derek Nimmo, and then comes Peter Jones and Wendy Richard, equal in third place. And Peter, your turn to begin. The subject, fawn. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Well, fawn was, or still is, as far as I know, the first name of Colonel Oliver North's secretary. A lady I'd very much like to employ myself. With her shredding machine. And she could come and tidy up my office and make it spick and span and generally make it much more decorative than it is in the normal way. She sounded to be a delightful and very loyal person, I thought, and I would rather have seen more of her on the screen than her employer. But, alas, it was not to be. I don't know whether she's gone on the stage or into films,
But if she has, then I would suggest that she's probably done terribly well and will continue to do so in Hollywood, Los Angeles, or, to make a list of it, London and Hamburg and other places like Rome, Naples, and Budapest. She may easily become a big star in the media. Now, I don't know how the time is going or whether you have any plans later this evening, but... What?
Carry on.
Evil.
Peter, as you've gone magnificently for 60 seconds, I thought I'd be rather mean and let you see how my song is going.
Dreadful.
God, this woman must have really affected you. You've got... First time you've gone for over 60 seconds without hesitation, repetition, or deviation. My goodness.
Amazing.
So 2 points, Peter Jones. And you're still in third place, I'm sorry to say. Clement, it's your turn to begin. The subject is Greece. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
I was recently invited to go to the Balearic Islands to play the balalaika and said, surely Greece would be a better place for this. And they said, all right, and sent me to Athens. You go to London Airport, and the Greek plane is the one that usually leaves 45 minutes after the time that it should, because it is run by Olympic Airlines, who have been singularly unkind to me in the provision of free seats of late. And I thought that perhaps if I mentioned their name on this program, much benefit would accrue as a consequence.
Wendy Richard,
I think that's deviation.
Why?
Well, he's rambling on about getting free seats on planes now.
Well, he won't get one now because he called them Olympic Airlines and they're actually Olympic Airways, you see. You've got a correct challenge, Wendy, in 25 seconds to tell us something about Greece, starting now.
I have never been to Greece, but I have several friends who have been, and they all tell me what a wonderful place Greece is. Apparently, once you are there, it is quite cheap. The food, the wine,
Peter Jones, yes. Challenge.
It's no more...
I only said two things. How can I have a list with beginning two things of... and you go on for half an hour?
The beginning of a list.
But actually, Clement didn't challenge you. It was Peter Jones who challenged you.
Oh, was it?
Peter, what was your challenge?
Well, nobody can probably remember what she was saying. It's so long ago. Yes. She said it's very cheap when you get there. And in fact, it's no cheaper when you get there than it is before you arrive.
Well done, Peter.
I used to like you, Peter. I've said lovely things about you.
It's 11 seconds for Greece. Peter Jones, starting now.
I've always wanted to cruise around Greece in a yacht. What a pity I never knew Robert Maxwell. Because he might have taken me on his wonderful boat, and I think that the influence of a good person...
So Peter Jones was again speaking as a whistle and gained an extra point, another in the round, so he's now creeping up on Derek Nimmo, who's now only 1 point behind our leader, Clement Freud, and Wendy, surprisingly, is in fourth place. But, Derek, it's your turn to begin. We had this and that, and now we've got doodads. 60 seconds, starting now.
I suppose when you use the word doodah, you mean thingamajig or thingamabob or some...
Wendy Richards.
Thingamy twice.
Two thingamajigs.
No, they're not. One word.
Thingamajig isn't one.
Yes, it is.
Well, I want to help Wendy for once. And Wendy's going to tell us something about doodahs with 52 seconds to go, starting now.
I have several collections of various sorts. Of
Clement Freud challenge.
I want to help Wendy as well.
All right, Wendy, you've got some more help. 49 seconds to tell us more about doodahs, starting now. And you said Clement Freud was so unkind to you. No, he's given you another point, you see. No, there was no hesitation there. Wendy, you've got another point. You're catching up rapidly now. So 48 seconds, doodah starting now.
I often forget the things that I have got in my house, so I refer to them as doodahs, i.e. my condiment set collection, some of my 2,000 frogs, and some of my clout...
Clement Freud challenge.
Two summer mice.
Two summarise, yes. So Clement's got in with another point, of course, for correct challenge. 36 seconds. Doodahs starting now.
There was an American song in which the chorus went doodah, doodah. Going to dance all day, doodah, doodah, doodah. It's really rather nice being able to repeat something on just a minute because it is the subject on a card. Doodah, doodah. The man who sang it blacked his face and whitened his teeth and moved his hands, which were gloved, in an anti-circular direction. Perhaps I meant a clockwise order. Doodah, doodah, doodah. It's a most agreeable sound.
Derek Nimmo,
I think there must be a limit to the number of doodah, as you can say. With every subject, we could just go doodah, doodah all the way through. Or taking side, taking side, taking side, taking side, whatever that.
Well, you challenged because he had too many doodahs.
A surfeit of doodahs.
Yes, a surfeit of doodahs. I think we did overplay the doodahs. So, Derry, we give you the benefit of the doubt. 3 seconds on doodah starting now.
Nicholas Parsons has a very attractive doodah. I have seen many times when I...
So, Derek, you got a point for speaking as the whistle went. You've crept forward again. You're now equal with Clement Freud in the lead and with Wendy Richard and Peter Jones equal in second place. Wendy, your turn to begin. Getting to sleep. Will you tell us something about that starting now?
I never have any trouble getting to sleep. It's staying awake that seems to be my problem most of the time. But once I get into my little bed with my Rupert Bear hot water bottle, I find I'm getting to sleep in no time at all.
Derek Nimmo-Challenge.
Well, I want to know where the carpet layer is.
I'm not going to discuss my husband with you. I'm talking about...
I mean, you know, if I'm so recently married, you only get into bed with a Rupert Bear. It doesn't seem awfully sad.
Really, Derek.
And I don't want any jokes about Underfelt either.
You've had all those already, have you?
Oh.
Right. So, Wendy, there are 47 seconds of an incorrect challenge, and you have another point, of course. Getting to sleep, starting now.
As I was saying before I was so rudely interrupted, getting to sleep is never a problem for me.
Clement Freud is challenged.
Repetition.
Oh.
Never a problem.
Never a problem. You said the first time, getting to sleep is never a problem. Clement, you have another point, and you have getting to sleep. 41 seconds, starting now.
I find it quite difficult to get to sleep and tend to...
Peter Jones, a chance.
Very slow there. It was a hesitation in between. Getting to sleep.
You don't think so, no.
You don't?
I agree with Peter. I thought there was a hesitation.
I thought there was.
I thought he just dozed off, eh? Yeah.
No, I don't think he hesitated. Clement, you have another point. 37 seconds on getting to sleep, starting now.
As a consequence, I count sheep. Oh, look, I say. Here's one. There's another. A lamb comes next. And because one cannot mention the bovine again...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Sheep aren't bovine.
They're bovine at cows.
That's why you can't mention them again.
A very good reply, but you don't struggle out that way, Clever. No, Peter, I agree with you. 24 seconds are left on getting to sleep, starting now.
Repetition is something that actually does send me off, and if... Clement had said doodah another 37 times after the first 39, I think I should have been asleep this evening, which would be a great pity because I should have missed that wonderful, interesting conversation about thingamy and whether it's got a hyphen before you say Bob and so on, which I'm sure are very edifying to the World Service listeners all over the globe.
Peter, you kept going to the whistle end, gain an extra point. But alas, we have no more time to play just a minute this week. So let me tell you what the final scores were. Wendy Richard, who gave a marvellous value as always, finished in fourth place, just behind Peter Jones. But we have two people out together, only 3 points ahead of them, equal. So we say they are the winners this week. That's Derek Nimmo and Clement Freud, joint winners. I hope you've enjoyed this edition of Just a Minute.
And it only remains for me to say, on behalf of our four players, Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones, Wendy Richard and Clement Freud, also the timekeeper and whistleblower and Ling, also the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, our producer, Sarah Smith, and myself, Nicholas Parsons, thank you for tuning in, and we hope you want to tune in again the next time we take to the air and play Just a Minute.
Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to welcome you all to Just a Minute. And we welcome back Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones, Clement Freud, and John Junkin. Would you please welcome all four of them? And once more, we are in Highgate School with boys from the school, parents, and other people who live in North London. So we welcome them to this particular edition of Just a Minute. As always, I will introduce Anne Ling, who's sitting beside me. She will keep the score and let me know when the 60 seconds are up. And as always, the basic rules are the same. I'm going to ask them to speak, if they can, on the subject I give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject on the card. We'll begin the show this week with Derek Nimmo, and Derek, the subject is what? Would you please take that subject and talk, if you can, for 60 seconds, starting now.
What's his name? What you may call it. Rather useful phrase, really. What is the neuter form of who, and therefore can be used quite extensively? James Watt was born in Scotland, lived in Clydesdale like Nicholas Parsons, and worked in the dockyards. I don't know if he sat on a five-seater lounge like Nicholas, but perhaps he did.
Clement Freud challenged.
Repetition of Nicholas.
Effectively, yes. I was fascinated by this word Clydesdale, which is a horse, not Clydeside, which is
you
an error. Remember.
You did sit on a five-seater lounge.
I did sit on a five-seater. It was a much more than that. It was seven or eight, actually. But you
lots of other people working in the dockyards beside him. Not a very pretty sight, is it?
Derek has seen my one-man show where I describe some of the problems I had as a young apprentice on Clydebank and having to go and obey the laws of nature in a very primitive latrine arrangement. It doesn't mean a thing to you, does it? Clement, you had a correct challenge, so you get a point for your correct challenge, and you take over the subject of what, and you have 38 seconds left, starting now.
What is an anagram of Thor? What is also how government offices answer the telephone these days? You say, is that 496-3287? And they say, what?
And
enough,
Maureen Lipman is challenged, but she's...
No, she hasn't.
It isn't, of course. It's our other guest, John
Junkin. A very
Junkin.
Superficial resemblance, I think.
Yes.
Husband said I've got better legs. That's another thing.
John Junkin, you challenged. What was your challenge?
Repetition.
Of what?
Inflection. Everything he says sounds exactly the same.
Very good.
That's a very clever challenge. It doesn't mean a thing in Just a Minute, because it's not contrary to one of the rules. But, John, I'll give you a bonus point, because we like the challenge, and you haven't played the game for 11 years, and...
I haven't worked for 11 years.
That's why I confused you. Right, now, 22 seconds left, starting now.
All I can say is, what... I mean, if I'm going to keep the subject and not get any points, I might just as well give it away.
John Junkin has challenged again.
Deviation.
Why?
He wasn't talking about the subject.
You're
he was
quite
talking
right,
about
John,
his points.
Yes. Yes.
What?
John, you have another point. You have the subject of what? 14 seconds starting now. And Peter Jones has challenged.
Hesitation.
Absolutely right. You have 40 seconds on what, starting now.
I have this picture of James Watt as a boy
sitting beside the fire in his poor cottage somewhere in the highlands of Scotland, watching the kettle boil, and the steam lifted the lid, and he had the idea that this power...
Peter, you were speaking as the whistle went, so you get a bonus point for doing that. And you're now in the lead with John Junkin at the end of the first round. And Clement Freud, will you take the next round? The subject is My Last School Report. Very apt to talk about that in another school, but will you tell us something about it starting now?
My last school report was very loud. I went to school during the war, and we had guns, all sorts of artillery, as well as rifle and pistol fire. And when you passed the village of Crowthorne, all you heard was noise of reports of all sorts of weaponry, which I now forget. There's also something called a school report, wherein masters gave an assessment of your qualities. And I remember quite particularly that I was rather an odious child and met a fellow who went to the same scholastic establishment called Surbiton. And I said to him, what sort of chap was I when we were together? And he said, you were an extraordinarily pleasant, nice, good-looking, athletic, warm, genuine...
John Junkin, challenge.
Can you challenge on dishonesty?
Exaggeration, I don't know, but...
Reported dishonesty.
I don't know whether that was deviation, because this fellow actually might have said that to me, might have been wanting to get something out of Clement Freud, even though it wasn't true. So, strictly speaking, no, it was an incorrect challenge. So Pema gets another point. He has my last school report and 14 seconds left to continue, starting now.
My last school report was on a piece of paper with headings and subheadings, like history, geography, mathematics, arithmetic, English, literature.
A daring Nimmo challenge.
We can't have had mathematics and arithmetic.
Yes.
You're quite right. Arithmetic
You're
would have come
quite wrong.
Well, as I know the school in question, I must say my school never reported had arithmetic as a separate subject from mathematics.
They were at school together, and I must tell you, actually, Freud was his prefect, and he's been terrified of Freud ever since.
I don't think we'll comment on that. Derek, I agree with your challenge. You have 2 seconds to tell us something about my last school report starting now.
It said, Derek Nimmo's field of knowledge is very wide, but not very deep.
That's a very interesting situation in just a minute. At the end of that round, they all have exactly the same number of points. 2. John Junkin, you take the next round, which is exercise. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Exercise is something we are exhorted to indulge in by television, radio, magazines, and newspapers. Experts advise us that this is necessary. They say that our body is a temple. If that is the case, I must admit, unfortunately, that mine is probably a desanctified Methodist chapel. I have had no interest in physical education, or PT, as it was known when I was at school, because I could never see the relevance of requesting...
Peter Jones, a chap.
He repeated never.
Yes, you did say never twice.
Yeah, but the first time was 11 years ago, Peter.
Actually, they were enjoying it because it was so interesting and explicit that I think they were rather disappointed. You can't continue, but Keto Jones is going to take over the subject and tell us something about exercises. 26 seconds to go, starting now.
It's the only thing to do when you're dieting, because without it, you don't lose any weight. Now, the idea is to shed poundage. So you take in less nourishment, particularly of the fattening type, and you exercise madly most of the day when you're not actually eating or drinking glasses of cold water.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, it was a hesitation, Derek. You have a point. You have 5 seconds exercise starting now.
Military exercise was something which I really enjoyed when I was a soldier, particularly brave, and there was always out with the guns.
Derek Nimmo was speaking as the whistle went and gained that extra point, and he's taken the lead at the end of the round. Peter Jones, will you take the next round, philately? That is the subject starting now.
Phil Latterly was a great success in Bilko. Now, formerly, he'd been on the circuit.
John Junkin, chap.
Hesitation.
No, it wasn't. He was sort of... He was playing the audience with his laugh.
That's what I was doing.
Yes,
that's what I was doing.
Peter, you continue with the point for a wrong challenge. 51 seconds for Natalie, starting now.
Going around the Orpheum circuit in the United States in shows... I hesitated.
Yes, there was an error there.
I gave the audience a chance to sort of, you know, but they didn't, and so I went... I've no excuse, really, at all.
46 seconds with you on philately, Derek, starting now.
I bet if Sir Owen Hill hadn't invented the penny paste, there would not be any philately, and so Stanley Gibbons would not have made the enormous fortune that he must have accrued over the years because people do collect postage stamps. I collected them myself when I was very young and liked it very much because I had not been many published at that time.
Clement Freud, chance.
Repetition.
Of what?
Very, very.
Yes, like it very, very much.
Very much, very young.
I'm not quarreling, it's all right.
They always try and bluff me out of it. Have you noticed that? If it's against them, they look at me and much say, you damn give it against me.
We don't look at you like, we look at you with contempt.
I think you should speak for yourself, Derek. I really do.
No, I think he speaks for many of us.
Do you wonder how I've survived 25 years of this? Goodness me, 30 seconds are left with you, Clement, on philately, starting now.
I recently went to the town of Liechtenstein, well, the town of Vaduz. I think we ought to have a challenge here. Quite right.
There's no repetition.
Shall I start again?
No, you can't. That's the game, 26 seconds, Derek. Philately, starting now.
The Queen's head on a black stamp, Victoria is the monarch that I mean, fetches still a very high price. Many times the face value, which was...
John Junkin, chap.
The face.
Yes, face value, the face of the Queen.
All right, I know. Right.
John Junkin, you have a correct challenge. 15 seconds, philately, starting now.
I always found the most fascinating part of philately was the stamp mounting, because as a child I put a totally different connotation on it than I do now. What we used to do...
Clement, yes.
Hesitation.
That wouldn't do it. I'm afraid it's hesitation, John. I'm terribly sorry.
I was playing the audience for a laugh.
I know. Unsuccessfully, I'm afraid. Clement, you have 3 seconds to tell us something about philately, starting now.
The economy of this small country in the Swiss Alps is totally...
John Junkin, John.
Aviation, what's that got to do with philately?
Well, he's just coming to it.
He was just...
But he didn't get to it.
I know, but he did only have 2.5 seconds.
Exactly, and he didn't get to philately in those 2.5 seconds.
I know.
How long is one allowed to have... before one gets to the subject. There ought to be some real...
It's left to my judgment and whim at the particular moment.
At
this particular moment, I'm going to go with the audience and say that they want John Junkin to have the subject. Of course, you didn't get that laugh that you tried for just then. They're sorry for you, see. You have another point, and you have 30 seconds on philately, starting now.
Stamp albums...
So John Junkin got an extra point too for speaking as the whistle went, and he's in second place behind Derek Nimmo, and then comes Peter Jones and Clement Freud, equal in third place. And Derek, your turn to begin, and the subject is Alexander Graham Bell. Will you tell us something about that gentleman in this game, starting now?
Alexander Graham Bell ought to be the patron saint of Maureen Lipman, because if he hadn't invented the telephone, she wouldn't be able to make a cash bid for the Lady Ghislaine. And I think it is of tremendous importance to the whole world that this man lived and invented and produced the machine that I've mentioned.
John Junkin.
Hesitation.
No, it wasn't quite hesitation, John. That was a bit sharp. Otherwise, we never get underway. I'm sorry. So, Derek, you have another point in 39 seconds. Alexander Graham Bell starting now.
Alexander Graham Bell was born in Scotland, emigrated to Canada, moved to America, and made untold riches because of the thing that he produced, which we all use daily, and in England we now call BT. But it's rather surprising, too. They also invented the kind of gramophone. Didn't quite have...
Peter Jones, chap.
He mentioned invented twice, I think, didn't he?
Oh, at least, I think. I would say 3 times.
Definitely, yes. Yes. So, Peter, you have a point for a correct challenge. Well listened. 19 seconds left. Alexander Graham Bell starting now.
Alexander Graham Bell shares with Andrew Lloyd Webber a middle name, like Adrian Brunel. I can't remember the other man's name.
Adrian Brunel.
No, whatever his name. Kingdom.
Isambard.
Kingdom. Isambard. Yes, that's right. Yes.
The lesser known brother.
Yes. Adrian Bell.
Oh, yes. That's what I'm thinking of.
Isambard Adrian Bell.
Adrian something else, I think.
Yeah. It was you, was it, Clement? Right. 10 seconds are left on Alexander Graham Bell, starting now.
There is a school of thought that believes that Alexander Graham Bell's surname was Ring. So when somebody said, I will give you a bell, one...
John... John
repetition of bell.
Yeah, but you see, you're allowed to mention, repeat the words on the card. It's one of the rules.
Even in a different connotation?
Mm-hmm. Yes, even in a different connotation.
Too late to resign.
No. I don't think we've changed that in the last 11 years, John, but it is difficult if you haven't been back.
I defer to you.
But no, I think you should. And we love your keenness. I don't want to inhibit that at all. But it was an incorrect challenge. So Clement has another point and 1 second on Alexander Graham Bell, starting now.
I think he would be surprised.
And an extra point. He's now in the lead alongside Derek Nimmo and Peter Jones and John Junkin, only a little way behind, equal in second place. Clement, your turn to begin the subject wine. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Wine is an anagram of Wien, which is the capital of Austria, known in this country as Vienna. And in that land, which I have just mentioned and cannot again, they produce a wine early on, rather as
a Peter Jones challenge.
He didn't mention the country. He mentioned the city.
Well, listen, Peter.
No. I said Vienna is the capital of Austria.
Oh, yes, you did. Yes, right. Yes.
Well, listen.
Austria, yes.
See, you're not paying any more attention than I am.
I was just trying to help you, Peter.
I know.
It is easy to doze off, Peter.
Yeah. I know it is. Yes. Particularly when you get onto these anagrams every time, you see.
That's what I find so tedious. So, Clement, yes, you're quite right. You did say it was the capital, and we thought it was Vienna, but of course you mentioned that country. So 46 seconds are with you, having got another point. Wine starting now.
France, Italy, Spain, Portugal, and the New World, especially Chile, Argentine, and, of course, Australia and New Zealand, produce wonderful wines, which many hotels and restaurants now list at quite accommodating prices. £4.95 is one that springs to mind. And recently in the West Country, I visited a number of locations where catering took place, in all of which the sommelier or wine waiter offered me a drink of enormous appeal at prices well within my purse. £12.85 plus VAT.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
A repetition of pound.
Yes, so £12, £4, 95 and £12. Clement, you kept going magnificently, but 7 seconds have left still for Derek to tell us something about wine, starting now.
I quite agree with Mr. Clement for once, actually, that some of the wines in the New World are quite extraordinary. The Chardonnays from New Zealand in particular, Cloudy Bay.
Right. So, Derek Nimmo. Speaking as the whistle went, got that extra point, and he's gone into the lead, one ahead of Clement Freud, and then in third place, equal John Junkin and Peter Jones. And John, your turn to begin. The subject is terror. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Terror is an emotion which has been described as indefinable. I will attempt in this instance to define it for you. It is sitting here looking at these three implacable faces, defying you to continue speaking coherently and lucidly for 60 seconds. Terror is something which has been capitalized upon by authors and filmmakers, particularly in the last 10 years. James Herbert, Steven Spielberg, Stephen King, all...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Two Stevens.
Two Stevens, I'm afraid.
A feast of Stephen.
I can't call him Sid King. He'd sing.
You'd have to find another way to refer to him in just a minute, I'm afraid. Derek, another point to you. And the subject of terror, and 28 seconds starting now.
The reign of terror in Paris, and indeed the whole of France, about 200 years ago, when the Jacobins, led by Robespierre and all those other dreadful people, executed everyone, or guillotine them, perhaps, who had royalist connection.
Clement Freud challenged.
Deviation.
Why?
There was no perhaps about it.
they didn't necessarily have Rory's connections. Or perhaps had Rory's connections. They were not very discriminating.
Oh, how do you say there was no perhaps? I mean, I don't think really, within the rules of just a minute, he was deviating. So no, it was a good challenge. Give Clement Freud a bonus point, a Derricka point for being interrupted. He has 12 seconds on terror starting now.
When I was a boy, I used to be called a holy terror, wasn't I?
Clement Freud.
But that has got to be deviation.
Why?
From common language.
Why?
You listen to him.
When I was a little boy, used to be called a holy terror.
He was sort of burbling a bit.
I'm just trying to get it sort of jolly it all up a bit. It got us all so gloomy. I thought.
Well, you introduced the guillotine, for God's sake. <Yeah. laughs> Not very cheerful.
Right, a point to Peter. I'm still with you, Derek. You have another point. 10 seconds starting now.
I think there is tremendous terror every time you go down to the underground.
Yes, Clement.
Yes, Dish.
I give you that one, yes?
Well done, Clay.
5 seconds are left on terror with you, Clement, starting now.
Terracotta is actually my favourite colour.
John Junkin.
Deviation.
John. Why?
Because terror and terror are two different things.
That's right, it's terror, cotta, and it's not terror, cotta. Well challenged, Sean. He's not a script writer for nothing. Right.
Almost.
Almost. John, 3 seconds left on terror starting now.
Terror is an unspeakable feeling which fills you with awe.
At the end of that round, John Junkin got the extra point, but Derek Nimmo still in the lead, then Clement Freud, then John, and then Peter Jones. And Peter, your turn to begin. The subject now is circulars. Can you tell us something about that in this game starting now?
We don't like them much at our house. We keep a waste paper basket by the front door so that they don't come in very far. And every week we discard this box full of...
John Junkin,
chap. Hesitation.
I think it's a hesitation, yes. John, you have circulars now. You have 48 seconds starting now.
Circulars are considered to be junk mail, and when you open the envelope reluctantly because there is nothing else to read in the house and you have failed abysmally with the Guardian crossword, you understand why they have that particular denomination. They are inevitably catalogues...
Clement Freud challenged.
I thought there was hesitation.
I agree with you, Clement. So you have circulars now, and 31 seconds starting now.
Cures is a very unusual Christian name, and before being knighted... He was the sort of chap whom you would pass in the street without looking sideways. Circulars are things which, by law, many people do not permit you to throw through doors.
John Junkin, chap.
Hesitation.
No, there wasn't hesitation, but I've had deviation for this chap, circulars. I don't think he exists, actually, but I can't give it to you for hesitation. I'm sorry. 13 seconds are still with Clement, starting now.
There used to be placards on doors which said, no hawkers or circulars. And until...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Not placards, surely. Yes. Just little notices.
Yes, placards. I think that's going over the top of it.
I think it would be going much too far.
Definitely. So 8 seconds are left for you, Peter, on circulars starting now.
If you have a little business and you're trying to drum up more activity, then a circular is a very good idea. In fact, it's better if you get more...
Peter Jones got an extra point. At the end of that round, he and John Junkin are equal in second place, behind our joint leaders, Derek Nimmo and Clement Freud. Derek, your turn to begin. The subject is holidays. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Holidays really originally meant holy days. It doesn't mean that anymore. It's something to go for when you want a break. I am going to go off quite soon, in fact, to Egypt. I shall land in Cairo on the world's favourite airline and stay at the Nile Hilton Hotel, then go up Cairo to Neal Street. I shall book a steamer from Luxor to take me down south back towards the place that I really want to go. I think the temple at Karnes is the most extraordinary, and Dendera, the Potomac
wonderful building they constructed is one of the great sights of the world, and I long to get there because
John Junkin has challenged you.
Deviation. He's a long way from holiday.
Yes, he's talking about his
holiday. It's my idea of a holiday.
It may be your idea of a holiday, but you stopped talking about holidays. You're now talking about the temple and all the other sights that you see.
That's part of my holiday.
Derek. No, but you're supposed to talk about holidays in the plural,
yes.
You see.
I've been visiting several places.
You're now just...
I've been down to Cairo. I've just nipped up to Dendera.
You were talking about all the great sights that you can see in Egypt, which you may do on your holiday, but you were describing them, so you were not describing holidays. So John has a correct challenge, and 19 seconds left with a point, of course, starting now.
Holidays have become a major industry in this country. Television programs are devoted as to where you should spend your vacation, or vacances, as the French say, and one of the most successful pieces of film ever shown on the particular subject is Monsieur Hulot's Holiday, a film starring Jacques Tati.
So John Junkin was again speaking as the whistle went, and it's a very even contest still. Derek, Nimmo and Clement Freutzel in the lead. John Junkin catching them up as we move into the last round, 2 points behind. Peter Jones only 3 or 4 behind them as well. And the subject is with Clement. It's his turn to begin, and it's wasting time. Well, an apt subject to finish the show on, but will you start and tell us something in just a minute on that, beginning now?
Wasting time is not a subject that I can tell you a lot about, because we, on Just a Minute, do not ever offend against that particular code. Newsreaders, I think, are a most terrific waste of time. Weathermen spend many of their words describing patterns which I have no interest in whatsoever. But I think wasting time when you have an audience which is rapt and listening to each word that you mention, when you have such interesting information to give to all those who may be present, and hanging on to every word, washing your teeth.
John Junkin challenged.
Repetition of word. Every word and wasted words.
Wasted words. Well done, John. Word. You have another point. You're one behind our leader. The last round, 23 seconds left. Wasting time starting now.
Wasting time is an art which has been managed by very few people. The majority of those who have achieved distinction in it tend to become members of Parliament, where it seems to me that wasting time...
What was that?
Well, it was hesitation, but...
No, it wasn't hesitation, so he gets a point for that.
Good.
Correct challenge.
Right.
So he's now equal in the lead with everybody else, and there are 11 seconds left on wasting time, and 11 seconds to go to the end of the show. Still with you, John, starting now.
I am probably one of the few people who, during their educational career, managed to achieve an O level in wasting time. My form master said...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
He can't possibly have an O level in wasting time.
Well, as we're at a school, I couldn't possibly disagree with you. Derek Nimmo got him with 2 seconds to go, having gained another point, and it's wasting time, Derek.
Seventh-day Adventists and Jehovah's Witnesses waste my time.
And as I said a little while ago, this was going to be the last round. So let me give you the final score. Peter Jones finished in fourth place. He was only just a little way behind Clement Freud and John Junkin, who were equal in second place. But once again, as we return here to our outside broadcast to Highgate School, it was Derek Nimmo who just edged ahead with 2 points. And so we judge him to be the winner of the show this week. Four contestants for their contributions, because that's what makes the show, and we thank our audience who've assembled here at Highgate School for their cooperation in letting us come here. And on behalf of the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, also Anne Ling, who's deputized for him and kept the score admirably, and also our producer, Sarah Smith, and myself, Nicholas Parsons, hope you'll want to tune in again the next time we play Just a Minute. Till then, goodbye.
Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to introduce you the four talented personalities who this week are playing Just a Minute. We welcome back Derek Nimmo, Wendy Richard, and Paul Merton, and also to play the game for only the second time, Stephen Fry. Would you please welcome all four of them? And as always, I'm going to ask our four players of the game if they can talk on the subject that I give them without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject on the card. Let us begin the show this week with Derek Nimmo. Derek, the subject is a good hand. Can you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
I left Hong Kong Harbour. The boat was called Juliana, captained by a dear friend of mine called Oliver Vaughan, sailing down to Manila. When we got there, we realised that we needed a good hand, because although we were very accomplished amateur sailors, we weren't really quite clever enough.
Yes.
Well, it was earlier on, really. It seemed so deviated, but by the time he got round to it, it sort of vaguely come to some kind of sense, I suppose, about a good hand being necessary, but it was the usual name-dropping stuff about Hong Kong being strung out. All this. But no, it was lovely. I don't know. I resent everything I've just said.
It was lovely, and name-dropping, but it was a long time before he got to...
Good... Hong Kong is name-dropping.
You were mumbling over your words, dear. I mean, you couldn't understand what you said, so I think that comes as hesitation.
Kong.
I'm not talking about Hong Kong. We've all got used to you place dropping. It was you were fumbling about with sailors, Derek.
Derek, I've never known the more be so much against you. I can't imagine why. But, Stephen, you have a correct challenge. There are 43 seconds. You get a point for that, of course, and you can take over the subject of a good hand starting now.
Ace, king, queen, jack, 10 of spades, for example, would be a magnificent hand in the game of draw poker, or stud variation of that particular pastime, naturally. It means a hand because it's named after the five fingers. There are that number of cards dealt you in this particular pursuit, which we all love and adore. A good hand was also an 18th century slang term for a very good whipster or manager of horses. I wonder why my voice is going like this. However, that's not supremely relevant. It's a good hand, to return to the subject in hand, as it were, is also, of course, a helpful person.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Repetition of course.
Yes, you did say of course more than once. Yes. Derek, you have a correct challenge. You have 4 seconds to tell us something about a good hand, starting now.
It's always been said that Clement Freud has a very good hand.
Paul Merton, challenge.
I just couldn't bear it, really. On humanitarian grounds, deviating from his normal speaking voice.
Absolutely, very devious, the whole thing. Paul, you have half a second to tell us something about a good hand, starting now.
A good hand...
Whoever is speaking as the whistle goes gets an extra point. It was Paul Merton, so he has the lead at the end of that round. Stephen Fry, would you take the next round? The subject is cows. You can take it as cows with an E or cows without an E.
Oh, how sweet of you. How nice.
Wish I hadn't said it now. You have 60 seconds, Stephen, starting now.
Edwina Curry and Margaret Thatcher were both, I believe, in power at the time of bovine spongiform encephalitis, which was a disease that struck cows. This may strike some people as being remarkably relevant and germane.
Derek Nimmo, challenged.
Also, Edwina Curry wasn't in power at the time. She'd resigned quite a long time.
Well done, Derek. 44 seconds for you on cows starting
now.
Up.
I would think that Nicholas Parsons probably is a sacred cow. He's a sort of person that really can't be touched by any kind of insult.
Stephen Fry, challenge.
I had a spot of hesitation. Am I overreading the situation?
No,
I am,
no,
yes.
No, no. He was about to pay me a compliment for the first time, so he's going to continue.
I doubt it.
So, Derek, an incorrect challenge. Another point to you. 37 seconds, cows, starting now.
I'd like to go down to Cows Week with a good hand. It's very important, I think, to have a splendid semen.
Stephen.
Now, that was a hesitation, wasn't it?
That was hesitation, yes. Yes, it says. Yes, Wendy, that's a very dirty laugh. Watch it, please. Stephen, there are 31 seconds for you to tell us something about cows, starting now.
The most delightful, placid, ruminant quadrupeds you could find are cows. Aren't they worshipped by the Hindu? And who can doubt them? Because these creatures provide milk, all kinds of dairy produce, as well as their spouses offering meat for the discerning eater.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Well, that's not why the Hindus worship them, because they didn't eat them. That was the whole point of them.
Yes, no, I said who can blame them, because that's all. I didn't say that was the reason. I'm just saying
meat,
who can blame them.
Meat.
Yes.
Well, you're a Hindu, you know, you don't eat the most fruit.
No, I know that. I didn't say you did.
Hey,
I just said who can blame
your
them.
Conversation.
I'd like to query this word spouse. I mean, do they undergo some ceremony? Or...
Oh, yes.
Really?
Oh, they nose into a little field.
It's a bit more basic, the ceremony they go under, I can tell you. You know, the cow's taken to the bull and they're married.
They're married, are they?
Well, it's not sanctified.
Listen, I thought we were playing just a minute.
I agree with your challenge. You have 17 seconds to tell us something about cows, starting now.
Me? Oh, it's my guess. I wasn't quite sure who you'd given it to. Cows I like very much in the summertime. It's a wonderful 7 days of nautical exploits. And if you have a jolly jack tar beside you, when you get on to your catch and sail away round the island...
Well, Derek Nimmo was speaking then as the whistle went and gained an extra point for doing so. Wendy, it's your turn to begin, and the subject is chance. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, if you can, starting now?
Poker, liar dice, roulette, shemmy are all games of chance, none of which, I hasten to add, do I partake in, because I am not a gambler at all, although I have on the odd occasion had to visit the dog tracks, usually for a charity night, and that is when you take a chance on which creature is going to come in first, second or third place. I'm not very good at making these forecasts. I usually tend to panic and change the numbers. And that's when I find my first two ideas.
Stephen Fry, challenge.
No, repetition of first, the first two and first, second and third earlier on.
First, second and third, yes, and the first two. Oh, well, listen, Stephen, 27 seconds for you to tell us something
about...
I'm
suddenly the villain of the piece now.
Yes. Chance, starting now.
Well, Gregorian chants are amongst my favourite, I suppose. Medieval monastic.
Derek Nimmo.
That certainly has a T.
That has a T. Those are chants, and this is chants.
That's what I said, Gregorian chants. The word is chance. It's identical in sound. Chance, chance.
No, not it. Not if you have good diction, and I know it's disappointing in our country, but they are chants.
More than just good diction. You'd have
Gregorian
peculiar teeth.
Chants.
Well, I'll take
well
your word.
Tried.
Thanks.
You're trying
okay.
harder than the regulars.
Well, fair enough.
Really, you've learned very, very fast, Stephen. I disagree.
Fast.
I agree with your challenge. You have 23 seconds for chance, starting now.
Me, is it? Oh, sorry. Yes. I didn't
He began again last time with me, is it? Oh, sorry. He's always... It takes up a good few seconds.
Yes. Repetition of me,
like
oh, sorry.
Say it was one, because it's very difficult to understand your brain.
Stephen got in there. So, Stephen, you have 22 seconds to tell us something about chance, starting now.
We were chatting nimbly the other week, weren't we, about Simon Raven, who lives in Deal, whose novels deal with the malice of time and chance.
Derek Nimmo, chance.
Two deals.
Two deals.
Oh, yes, isn't that good? Because they're different. Isn't that silly? God.
You
Arts.
Derek, I know it's difficult at your age. I will speak very simply. You won that with 15 seconds to go, starting
now. If you want to play any kind of game of chance, the best place to go to is Las Vegas, that extraordinary town in Nevada. I remember going to the loo in that city and hearing someone win the jackpot in the next cubicle because the armies were absolutely everywhere. It probably was the most exciting moment of my life.
Very. You were speaking as a whistle when gained an extra point, and you've increased your lead at the end of that round. Paul Merton, your turn to begin. The subject is My Best Behaviour. Will you tell us something about that in this game starting now?
I'm always on my best behaviour when I come along to record Just a Minute. I listen patiently and carefully to what my other contestants are saying. I don't interrupt. I don't challenge them.
Wendy challenged.
You said don't twice.
Yeah, there were too many don'ts, I'm afraid. So Wendy got in with 48 seconds to tell us something about My Best Behaviour starting now.
I always try to be on my best behaviour, unlike some of my fellow compatriots on this programme.
Stephen Fry.
What's all this drivel about fellow compatriots? A compatriot means a fellow countryman anyway, so it's a deviant tautology.
Well, I think you are. It may be a touch of tautology, but on the other hand, you are also compatriots of hers, even if you are contestants. You're all of the same.
Well, you're all fellows, aren't you?
Yes. So I think you're getting a bit too keen.
Yes,
now,
I'm sorry, I am. You're right. A little rush of blood to the head there, darling.
40 seconds, Wendy, an incorrect challenge. You have another point, and you have 40 seconds to tell us more about My Best Behaviour starting now.
I always do.
And Stephen Fry challenge.
She always begins I always, and she did last time.
I always do, yes, I'm afraid so, yes.
Go on, then.
Yes.
Don't get on the wrong side of her.
Dangerous looks I'm getting now.
Wendy, you did repeat, I'm afraid, and Stephen got in with a correct challenge, and you have 39 seconds, Stephen, to tell us something about My Best Behaviour starting now.
My best behaviour, I suppose, tends to arise in any moment of some kind of tension when one is literally on one's best behaviour, trying not to say the thoughts that come to your mind.
Wendy, Richard challenge.
Did we have two tries?
Mm. Yes, you did try too hard there, I'm afraid, Stephen. Well, Wendy, you've got back in. Another point, 29 seconds, My Best Behaviour starting now.
Best behaviour is very important. One cannot go rushing about willy-nilly upsetting others all over the place. I certainly don't think so anyway. My best behaviour, I think, is to try and sit quietly, which is quite an achievement for me, in the corner somewhere and watch other people disporting themselves, usually in some rowdy or noisy manner. I was...
Stephen Fry challenge.
I leapt into a bit of a hole there, a bit of a...
Yeah, there was a hesitation, yes, Stephen. So you cleverly got in with only 3 seconds to go to tell us more about My Best Behaviour, starting now.
When confronted with members of the royal dynasties of other countries, it's always as well to be on one...
Well, Stephen Fry was then speaking as a whistle when gained that extra point, which is so valuable. And, Derek, it's your turn to begin. The subject, keys. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Key is rather a useful word, really. It can be used, perhaps, to say to the Mediterranean, Gibraltar is the key. Also, St. Peter...
Stephen Fry, challenge.
Yeah, hesitation, no.
It was a hesitation, yes. 52 seconds for you to tell us something about keys, Stephen, starting now.
Keys in Florida are said to be very splendid. There's Key West, which I believe is the southernmost part of that country, and there's Key Largo in a famous film with Edward G. Robinson, of course. And there are the keys in West...
Wendy, Richard Charles.
But key...
Right.
Nice.
That's right. Keys is the subject on the card. Can't repeat keys, but he repeated key. Well, listen, Wendy, you have 42 seconds to tell us something about keys, starting now.
I'm very grateful for Stephen Fry for interrupting Derek Nimmo at the start of this round. I thought we were going to be given another list.
A Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation. We haven't got round to the subject of keys yet.
No.
I was just coming to it. You'd have loved it what I was
going to say. Who can say?
Who can say? No, I think you have to establish much earlier that you're on the subject of keys. And so I agree with you, Paul. Deviation. 35 seconds. Keys starting now.
Some people like to use a key ring as a kind of sign of masculinity. They have this bunch of keys hanging down by their waistcoat, and you find out that most of these actual keys are for no good reason at all. There may be a key for the
Derek Nimmo challenge.
You said key twice as opposed to keys.
You said keyring, which is a hyphenated word.
Keyring is hyphenated. He didn't say keys.
I didn't say four twice, but then you didn't challenge me.
So no, he didn't say key twice. Paul, you have another point for an incorrect challenge, and you still have the subject of keys starting now.
When I was 21 years old exactly, I was given the key to the door. Unfortunately, I wasn't told which particular wooden partition this was, so I would go round London thrusting this key into various keyholes.
And Stephen Fry challenge.
That's two keys, key to the door and the key, thrusting this particular key.
The keys is the subject, is what Wendy's challenge was, and you had two singular key there. 4 seconds for you, Stephen, on the the subject of keys, starting now.
The West Indian keys are spelled very differently, naturally enough. Key can also mean confidence.
I was then speaking as the whistle went, and he's now equal in the lead with Derek Nimmo at the end of that round. Then's Wendy Richard and Paul Merton following in that order. And Stephen Fry, your turn to begin. The subject is morphology. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
There are two distinct meanings to morphology. The first is kind of biological, natural history word. It means the science of form. The Greek morphos means shape, as in metamorphosis. The other kind is grammatical and is used as an assignation...
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of kind.
Yes, you talked about the first kind, now the other kind, yes. Yeah, I mean, nice. I'm amazed.
Well, I don't particularly want this, but...
The audience have gone deathly quiet. They've lost in amazement at your depth of knowledge and your erudition. Is there 33 seconds for you to tell us something, Paul, about morphology, starting now?
There is a children's character made out of plasticine called Morph, and I do believe that his name is a...
Stephen Fry challenge.
Oh, no, he said named, didn't he? That was a meaningless interruption. Yes. I'm so sorry.
It was an incorrect challenge,
yes,
Stephen. Paul has another point. Yes. 30 seconds on morphology, starting now.
Any copy of the Oxford English Dictionary will contain the word...
Stephen Fry challenge.
Not a copy with that page ripped out.
I was going to say helicopter there.
I was going to say the H page ripped out, not have helicopter.
And only someone as mean as you would think of a challenge like that. He was not strictly deviating from the basic rules of just a minute. So, Paul, you keep the subject another point. 25 seconds of morphology starting now.
I had a pet dog once that I called Morphology, and I would take it for a walk in the park, and I would shout out, Morphology! Morphology! Morphology. And this canine would look around and wondered who was calling its name, and it would be me, Morphology. Name and name.
That's a name. That's
because you said it before named, and now you've got the name again.
Oh, blimey.
Yes.
Well, I only did metal work at school.
Stephen, you have 9 seconds to tell us more about morphology, starting now.
As an instance of the way the term is used, one might say that the morphology of a human being is to have a single head, 2 ears, 5 fingers per hand.
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of fingers, 5 fingers.
Well, it's deviation. It's 4 fingers and 2 thumbs.
That's what I meant.
One might say that, and many people do say that. One might say that a human being's morphology is such that it has 5 fingers. And, well, one might, young Nicholas.
Tactics they employ. You didn't say that, even though you might have tried to convey it. So Paul has another point and a correct challenge. 1 second on morphology, starting now.
My house...
Paul Merton was then speaking as the whistle went, got an extra point for doing so, and he is now equal in second place for Derek Nimmo. Our leader, 1 point ahead, is Stephen Fry.
Can a wing manager better whistle than that? It was pathetic noise, I thought.
Okay, it's your turn to begin. The subject is pop, and you have 60 seconds as usual, and you start now.
Now, does this mean pop as in music, or pop as in fizzy drinks?
Derek Nimmo challenged.
To as in.
As in. Don't ask the question, just take the subject and talk on pop whichever way you like, Wendy.
I know. Then once I'd established, you see, I was going to have 2 avenues down which to travel.
I'd save it.
You save it. Derek, you have 55 seconds after a correct challenge to tell us something about pop, starting now.
Up and down the city road, in and out the eagle, that's the way the money goes. Pop goes the weasel, because if you frequent that particular hostelry named after a bird of prey and drank a great deal, then you would have to go to a pawnbroker's and get rid of your weasel.
And Stephen Fry challenge.
Well, that's our second weasel, isn't it?
Yes, undenied. You've had the weasel too often. 35 seconds for pop, starting now.
Pop. I've just done it. It's a word used by sound engineers for that rather plosive noise on a P that you make against a microphone, for which there is...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Deviation. You can't pee against a microphone.
I don't know. We had a pee and a whistle a few minutes ago.
Give Derek a point for that. Stephen, you have an incorrect challenge, so you can have another point, and you keep the subject, and it is pop. 26 seconds are left, starting now.
A friendly diminutive endearment for one's papa is pop, isn't it? One's father. It's a very... Oh, once.
Wendy, challenge.
Two ones.
Well done, yeah. Yes, well done, Wendy. You have 20 seconds to tell us something about pop, starting now.
I'm not a great fan of pop music. I find...
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of music.
You mentioned music... Right at the beginning.
Oh, well, it was so long ago. I've forgotten. I'm sorry.
Paul Merton, you have 17 seconds taking over the subject of pop, starting now.
Pop can be an abbreviation of popular, and it popped up quite a few times in the early 60s. Pop music, indeed, was...
Wendy...
Music.
No, he hadn't said music before. You had.
No, you were buzzing yourself.
So, Paul, sorry, a wrong Paul. Challenge, and 8 seconds left for pop starting now.
And then, of course, there was pop art, a movement in this country that people such as Peter Blake, the artist, were extremely well known for.
Well, at the end of that round, an interesting situation. Stephen Fry and Paul Merton are now equal in the lead, only 1 point ahead of Derek Nimmo, and then Wendy following a little behind. And, Paul, it's your turn to begin. The subject, bottoming out. Will you take that any way you wish? And you have 60 seconds as usual. Start now.
Stephen Fry said to me before the show began tonight, he said, I'm afraid I'm bottoming out.
Stephen Fry.
Two saids. Said to me, he said.
Well, yes, he did indeed.
What did I say, by the way? I'm sorry.
Well, we'll find out.
We may not.
Yeah.
It may not. You got in very rapidly then, Stephen, and the 56 seconds are left, and you tell us now something about bottoming out, starting now.
The term, like so many popular ones these days, is originally American. It refers to a vectorial graph where something reaches a bottom, its base plateau, if you like, and continues along it. This is said to be bottoming out. Our Chancellor has claimed that our recession is bottoming out at the moment. It's scraping or bumping along the bottom, others prefer to say. However, bottoming out...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Two bottoms.
Yes, two bottoms.
Yes, there were two bottoms, yes, yes. Derek, well, listen, you have a point, you have 33 seconds, and you tell us now something about bottoming out, starting now.
My dear lamented late mother-in-law, one Lily Brown, of Clapham Road in Liverpool, bottomed out late in her life and became quite large in that particular area. To the Bon Marché shop in Liverpool, and she tried on...
Stephen Fry.
You've had Liverpool twice there, I think.
Yes, you had Liverpool before. Clapham Road, Liverpool.
I know, I'm
sorry.
Makes a change from Hong Kong, doesn't it?
Yes, Stephen, 17 seconds for you to tell us more about bottoming him out, starting now.
The great British workman is famed for bottoming out. He'll bend down to pick up a shovel and whips, there are those two splendid cheeks with a little bit of hair down the cleft, peeping out at us for all to see. The road menders and the drillers of pneumatic drills always seem to bottom out in public. Nobody quite knows why, but it's rather enjoyable as a sort of tourist sight.
Audience here have obviously seen what you described. Yes, I must say. Stephen, you kept going until the whistle went, so you gained that extra point, and you've actually taken the lead at the end of that round, ahead of Paul Merton and Derek Nimmo, equal in second place, and then Wendy. And Stephen, your turn to begin. Fishing. Will you tell us something about fishing in 60 seconds, if you can, starting now?
Fishing sounds very like the Cantonese for underpants. I assume, however, you're referring to the pescatorial arts, those of coarse fishing, fly fishing, and any other kind of fishing one might care to mention. I'm not a great fisherman, as it happens, Nicholas. This may or may not interest you. I know little about it. I did some fishing.
We went to Mays, didn't we? May or may not.
Oh, yeah.
May or may not.
Yeah.
God. 45 seconds. Wendy, you picked it up. Fishing, will you tell us something about that subject, starting now?
My husband is keen on fishing, and some years ago, when we were in Ireland, it was his birthday, and off he went fishing. A boat was arranged for him. He came back with this specimen fish, and he got a certificate and a badge from the Irish Fishing Board. This was all very marvellous for him, and I was very proud of him.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Too many hymns.
Yes, there are too many hymns.
Oh, it's such a little word.
I know. Obviously, I mean, you didn't get in on it, but... but if, I've got to be fair, she did say him more than once, so, Derek, you came in and you have a correct challenge. 23 seconds are left for fishing starting now.
I think probably the most exciting days of fishing I've ever had in my life was in the Rakaia River on the South Island of New Zealand. We were staying at Mount Snowdon Station, and we went down into the river, and there are casting...
Stephen Fry challenge.
Second river, though.
Yes.
Went down into
you
the river.
You can't possibly fish unless you've got a river, can you?
True. But you only need one. Just need the one.
You just
one
want
river
to go to the river once. Stephen.
Pond.
15 seconds to tell us something about fishing, starting now.
As a young person, I would occasionally fish for sticklebacks in the lakes.
Yes, there was a hesitation there.
Not many.
Wendy, you've got 10 seconds on fishing, starting now.
To get back to my original story, I heard the tale of this amazing thing that Paul had caught for 6 months afterwards.
Paul Merton, challenge.
Repetition of caught.
Yes, you came back because you caught a fish before, you see.
Oh. That's right. I thought you'd all be interested to hear how it
finished.
Yeah,
we were.
Well,
what happened,
Wendy?
Well,
tell us, because only half a second ago, what actually happened?
Well, no, that was it. He just still talked about it for 6 months afterwards. I mean, he still goes on about it now.
That's the payoff
pretty
to the story.
Pretty flabby story, Wendy.
you should get him on repetition.
Yes. Paul, you got in cleverly with half a second to go on fishing starting now.
J.R. Hartley.
Paul Merton was speaking as the whistle went, gained that all-important extra point. I don't think you'd have won anyway, Wendy, but you did do very well. You finished in fourth place, but a lot of points. Derek Nimmo was in third place, a lot of points. Stephen Fry, who's only played the game once before, got a tremendous number of points. And he finished in second place, but just 1 point ahead of him, Paul Merton. This edition of Just a Minute, and it only remains for me to say, on behalf of all four of our clever and amusing contestants, Wendy Richard, Derek Nimmo, Paul Merton, and Stephen Fry, and Ling, who's been keeping the score, and also the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, and our producer, Sarah Smith, and me, Nicholas Parsons. Thank you for tuning in. We hope you enjoyed the show as much as we enjoyed playing it, and will want to be with us again the next time we take to the air and play Just a Minute. Until then, from all of us here, goodbye. Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once again, it's my pleasure to introduce to you the four talented players who are going to play Just a Minute this week. We welcome back Paul Merton, Clement Freud, and Peter Jones, and we welcome someone who has never played the game before, Tony Hawks. Would you please welcome all four of them? And Ling is here to keep the score and blow her whistle when 60 seconds are up. And in front of me are the subjects, which I will ask our four players to speak on, if they can, without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from that subject. And we begin the show this week with Paul Merton. Paul, the subject is My Silliest Habit. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
My silliest habit is agreeing to appear on Just a Minute, because every year I forget how difficult this particular game is, and yet every 12 months I do consent to appear on that particular programme. I find that some of the rules are now very...
And Peter Jones,
I lost the will in the middle.
Hesitation.
Yeah, yes, definite hesitation. So, Peter, a correct challenge, you get a point for that, and you take over the subject of My Silliest Habit. 44 seconds are left, starting now.
I'm very reluctant to reveal what my silliest habit is, because I would only giving people a stick to beat me with, and I don't, and that isn't the habit, incidentally. I wouldn't like my wife to listen to the radio and find out what it is, because at the moment I manage to keep it a secret. and I'm going to keep it the same way.
And Tony Hawks are challenged.
Did he do repetition of keep?
He did do repetition of keep, Tony. And so you got in with your first challenge, your first point, and 21 seconds are left for you to tell us something about my silliest habit, starting now.
Well, I have a very silly habit indeed. Perhaps the silliest habit in my road, because I enjoy very much poking people with sticks. Quite similar to Peter Jones' habit in some ways, I suppose. But I like to irritate them by doing this. If they turn up at my front door, I take my little sharpened wooden projectile and prod away at them until they become very angry indeed. Sometimes they strike me...
Whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point. And on this occasion, it was Tony Hawks. And Peter, your turn to begin. The subject, Malta. Will you tell us something about that place in this game, starting now?
The island in the Mediterranean. I remember it very well. It was the first place I went to after the war that was abroad. And I remember so well the two girls by the duty-free...
Clement Freud challenged.
Repetition of remember.
Yes, you remember too much, Peter.
Pity you're never going to hear this story. Well, I may get back in, I suppose.
You'll get back in again?
Yes, sure.
It's a good story, is it?
Well, it's quite funny.
Right. Well, we'll see if we can have it afterwards. Clement, you have 49 seconds to tell us something about Malta, starting now.
It is an island in the Mediterranean, as Peter Jones...
Well, I just said that. I mean, it's terribly boring to repeat what the previous speaker has said. Good heavens,
I know,
we're
but
going to do that.
Nothing in the rules that says you can't do that, Peter.
Well,
you've made your point, Peter.
Right.
And it's been taken on board, but it still doesn't apply. Clement, you have 45 seconds. Tell us more about Malta, starting now.
It is a large... It is a large city in the Atlantic Ocean.
But Paul Merton challenged you before you got there. Sorry. Yes, Paul, what was it?
Hesitation, I'm afraid.
Yes, and he was trying to remember exactly what Peter said so he could say it. 42 seconds for Malta with you, Paul, starting now.
Malta is an island in the Mediterranean. And it was the first place I visited after the end of the Second World War. I remember particularly two...
Tony Hawks have challenged.
I think I know how old Paul is, and he wasn't quite old enough to take part in the Second World War.
So that was deviation.
Deviation. Telling fibs, yes.
So I said after the Second World War. I didn't say what period after the Second World War. It might have been in 1965.
I know, but I'd like to hear from Tony Hawks on Malta as well.
Oh, I'm sure you...
So, Tony, I agree with your challenge. You have 33 seconds to tell us something about Malta, starting now.
Well, my...
Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation. He didn't start by saying Malta is an island in the Mediterranean.
I agree with you, Paul. So you have another point and 32 seconds on Malta, starting now.
Their names were Sally and Mary, and they were very pleased to see me when I got off the boat. They came running up to me and they said, "You are the first Englishman that has arrived on our island since Wednesday, and we, according to local tradition, must shower you with love and presents." So they gave me a Black & Decker power drill and took me trousers down. Pleased and enamoured that this local custom...
Peter Jones has chucked.
Well, yes, he repeated, hesitated, did everything, really.
We've got a point for that, Peter, and the subject. Yes. There are 4 seconds left. Would you like more than 4 seconds in order to complete your story?
No, it doesn't matter. It's not important, really.
Well, it's funny. We wouldn't mind hearing it.
Well, I don't know.
Right, we'll see how it goes, and we'll blow the whistle when it stops being funny. There are 4 seconds, starting now.
And I asked the customs officer who was standing near me, hoping that I was going to take out the cannabis and the pornographic photographs that I never travel without. And I said, "Who are those two over there?" And he said, "Oh, they're very attractive, aren't they?" And I said, "They certainly are." He said, "We call them the two Maltesers."
Okay. Right. So Peter and his Maltesers brought that round to an end, and as he was speaking, as he said Maltesers, he gets a bonus point. And he's in second place behind Paul Merton at the end of that round. And Tony Hawks, your turn to begin. The subject, greens. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
I cannot tell you how frustrated as a child I was when I was having my dinner, when every time I was about to eat my food, along would come Mrs. Andrews, the dinner lady, and say, "Tony, will you please finish your greens?" Well, I wouldn't complete my meal because they were disgusting in flavour, and I had a special little trick which I used to do. I used to eat the baked potato and then put the greens...
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of used.
Yes, you did say used to three times, actually. That's the trouble. You have to find another way of saying
okay,
the same
I'll get
thing.
Him back. You wait.
Yes. 37 seconds with you, Paul Merton, on greens, starting now.
I was never particularly fond of greens at school. I think because they were quite badly prepared. You boil them for a long time and they lose all kinds of flavour. I am very fond of...
Tony Hawk's challenge.
I don't know what I damn means. So, hesitation.
I said I damn, but I didn't hesitate.
So he has to keep going with 26 seconds on greens starting now.
My favourite spinach is, well, it's a green, really, not my favourite gold.
Tony Hawks, yes, your challenge.
Well, that was repetition.
21 seconds for you, Tony, on greens starting now.
Spinach is a very good green to eat because it can make you very strong indeed.
And Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of very.
Clement, you've got him with 17 seconds on greens starting now.
My favourite greens are on the Mediterranean island of Malta, where there is a golf course of unexcelled beauty. And if you drive from the third tee and hit the fairway, you have every opportunity of landing on the green with your second shot.
Clement Freud gained that extra point for speaking as a whistle wind. And Paul, it's your turn to begin. The subject, rain. Can you tell us something about that in this game starting now?
I've never really fully understood the phenomena of rain. I know, obviously, that it come...
Clement Freud challenge.
It's a phenomenon.
You're right. That's a tough, mean challenge, but it's correct, so there are... And it's very early, too. 55 seconds for you to tell us something about rain, Clement, starting now.
W. Somerset Maugham, I seem to recall, wrote a story about rain. Sultry, temptress, red hair, Kuala Lumpur, Indonesia, sex, disgusting. I enjoyed it greatly when I was a small...
Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation, it's just a collection of words, we get it, don't we? Sentence there at all.
It was set in India anyway, Kuala Lumpur, all that.
India.
Kuala Lumpur's in Malaya.
And that's India, is it?
No. The novel Rain was set in India.
Are yes, you I challenging me? Is that... The challenge was that I was using words.
That you were using words which were not applicable to rain, and on that basis I agree.
Yes, that's exactly what I was saying.
39 seconds, Paul, on rain, starting now.
The reign of Edward VIII never really got off the ground because he married Miss Wallis Simpson. Well, in fact...
Clement Freud challenge.
She was Mrs. Wallis Simpson.
She was
Mrs.
She was Clement, so you have 33 seconds.
She was a phenomena.
33 seconds for you on reign, Clement, starting now.
In Spain, stays mainly in the plain. And there is an island in the Mediterranean where it hardly ever rains at all, unlike Berkshire, Buckingham and Shropshire, where it buckets down. It is called, when you ski, the piste.
Challenged, yes.
Full stop, really, wasn't it? New yes. Paragraph, hesitation.
Yes. Is my buzzer working?
You want to try it?
Well, I press... Oh, yes.
Yes, it works beautifully,
funny,
Peter.
Can I press it then, you know? Yeah, I thought perhaps it was faulty, you know. It's not the first time that this arrangement has been tampered with. Some people will stoop to anything. I saw Clement in here about half an hour before.
So, he came to a full stop and who challenge? It was Paul Merton, wasn't it? 13 seconds on Rain's Paul, starting now.
There is a Beatles song called Rain that John Lennon recorded with that particular group. It's quite a unique tune in...
Clement Freud challenge.
Deviation.
Why?
You can't be quite unique.
No, I'm afraid you're unique or... Yes, that is deviation from grammar. So, Clement, you're picking him up on all these things... Really mean, aren't you today, Clement? Right, 6 seconds on rain, starting now.
Rain, go away, come again another day.
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition, the rain's come again another day.
That's a repetitious thought, but he wasn't repeating the words. We give him a bonus point because it was a very clever challenge, but Clement gets a point for an incorrect challenge. And he has 2 seconds, Clement, on rain, starting now.
It is a phenomenon, which is also...
the audience enjoyed that round on rain anyway. Clement, it's your turn to begin. The subject is First Baron George Jeffreys. And you have 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
The First Baron George Jeffreys was born in the 17th century and achieved fame and notoriety for his lack of judicial knowledge and his brutality. After the Monmouth Rebellion, he was ordered, in fact, by the Crown to hang people almost regardless of what they did. And I think the year would have been 1980.
Paul Merton, judge.
Deviation. The year couldn't have begun with a 19 if he had lived in the 17th century.
No, quite right. He was trying to find a way around it. He's failed. And, Paul, you've got in with 33 seconds on First Baron George Jeffreys, starting now.
Whenever I think of the First Baron George...
Tony Hawk's challenge.
I'm buzzing because he's actually saying that very slowly because he knows nothing about the First Baron.
You're probably completely right, but he didn't actually hesitate. And there are 29 seconds on First Baron George Jeffreys, starting now.
First Baron George Jeffreys was a pub round...
Peter Jones' challenge.
He said that already.
That's
very slowly.
Yes, he said that that's the subject on the card. You can repeat the subject on the card. I know you've only been playing the game for 25 years. But sometimes yes. Things do slip your memory, I realise.
Thank God it's merciful in that way.
And you still continue, Paul, with another point. 24 seconds, First Baron George Jeffreys, starting now.
First Baron George Jeffreys.
And Clement Freud challenge.
Deviation.
Why?
He's speaking much more quickly now.
He wasn't.
Right. As I... No, I will give Clement a bonus because I gave it to Paul when he was interrupted. Another point for interrupting Paul Merton to him. Paul gets another point and he continues on that subject.
Hang on, I don't get any points and I thought of this idea first.
A point to Tony Hawk because he hadn't played the game. And he thought of it. And a point for Peter because of that lovely remark he made at the last round. So they've both all got points now. And Paul Merton continues with 22 seconds on First Baron George Jeffreys starting now.
He was, of course, known as the Hanging Judge, and it's a kind of indication of the brutality of the age in which he lived that he is still remembered by people even today. It must have been an extraordinary experience to find yourself facing First Baron George Jeffreys in the dock, and you'd look up at those cold blue eyes and realise that even...
Peter Jones' challenge.
Hazel, actually. Yes.
And you were there at the time to be very...
No, but he happens to have been Baron of Wem, and that's the town in Shropshire that I actually was born and brought up in. So I do know what I'm talking about.
Well, according to my mother, he was one of her ancestors, and she said that he had brown eyes.
Brown, hazel, schmazel.
All right, let's the audience judge.
Oh. What can they judge what colour Judge Jeffreys are?
That is the whole point.
It's your responsibility as a chairman.
Anyway,
I'm opting out of the responsibility because I don't know what the colour his eyes were.
Well, Paul did say cold blue eyes, so hazel eyes, when they're cold, do go a little bit blue, apparently.
Oh, why do you want to make an effect?
Especially if you're wearing contact lenses as well.
Judge Jeffreys always wore contact lenses, didn't he?
Well, you've just decided he's got hazel eyes, haven't you?
No, that's the whole point. I didn't decide. The audience decided.
No, your mother decided. She's going to be very upset, isn't she?
She's probably up in heaven with Judge Jeffreys or down in hell trying to find out where he is.
Oh, I didn't realise that. What bad taste. I had no idea. You shouldn't have brought her into it at all. I haven't brought my mother into it. She's passed away also.
To be honest, I wish I'd never mentioned his eyes.
Right, you were just trying to eke it out of me. Make it dramatic.
Well, I think we're getting back to playing in just a minute. And
right.
Peter, you have half a second.
Half a second, are you?
Half a second with hazel eyes of Judge Jeffreys starting now.
Bloody Judge Jeffreys.
Now,
kept going for half a second till the whistle went. You gained that extra point, and you're still in third place. And Paul Merton's in the lead, and Peter Jones, it is your turn to begin. The subject is short notice. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
Well, the shortest notice I remember seeing was in Diggs in Bradford. It may have been Halifax, but it was hanging on the chain in the bathroom, and it said, pull slowly and hold down. And I never understood quite why it did that. I didn't ever dare to pull it with a jerk.
And Tony Hawkes has challenged.
Repetition of pull it.
That's right.
Yes,
you
right.
Pulled it too often.
Yes.
Tony, that was a correct challenge. And you have 41 seconds to tell us something about short notice, starting now.
Well, I have just been asked by the very charming host of this programme...
Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation. He's not charming at all.
Take a point away from Paul Merton. Really? No, I wouldn't ever do that. Tony, I will not allow that challenge. So you have another point and 36 seconds on short notice starting now.
My, you are being deeply, deeply kind to...
And, Paul Merton... You got carried away, didn't you? You can't do that in just a minute. 33 seconds, short notice starting now.
About 10 minutes is the shortest notice recorded... by a man who got a job in the kitchen department of a department store...
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of department.
There were two departments there, Clement, so 24 seconds are left for Paul Merton to tell us about short notice starting now.
2 pints, please, milkman, is the shortest notice I've ever seen, which is someone...
Peter Jones challenged.
1 pint would be shorter.
Personal experience. I've only ever seen 2 pints, you see.
Yeah, right. OK, well, 1 point to Peter, for we liked his challenge. A point to Paul, because he was interrupted, and he continues on. 19 seconds, Paul. Short notice, starting now.
I think it was the American drama critic Robert Benchley who wrote a criticism of a play called I Am a Camera, and his notice was Me No Liker, which at the time was considered the height of 1930s sophisticated wit. He, of course, was a member of the Algonquin Club, which...
was then speaking as the whistle went, gained an extra point and has increased his lead. And Tony Hawkes, it's your turn to begin. The subject is crosswords. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
I'm one of these people that finds it very difficult indeed to do crosswords. I get very frustrated by them, particularly the cryptic clues. Things like, jousting man reaps reward for tomorrow's centipede. And then I'm horrified to buy the paper the next day to find the answer to that is in fact...
Paul Merton challenge.
Was it a repetition of find?
Yes, but we want to know what the answer was. Yes, you were quite right, Paul. It was a repetition. And there are 43 seconds for you on crosswords starting now.
I believe the first crossword was invented around about the turn of the century. Like Tony, I don't particularly enjoy doing them. I sometimes have a go at the easy clues, but when it comes to the cryptic ones, I find them absolutely impossible.
Tony Hawk's challenge.
Repetition of everything I've just said?
It's not really stylish.
No.
But it doesn't contravene the rules of just a minute.
OK.
So Paul's got another point for an incorrect challenge and 30 seconds on crosswords starting now.
I remember one crossword clue, island in the Mediterranean.
Tony Hawk's challenge. Yes, Tony, your
repetition
challenge.
Of clue.
That's right. He wasn't clued up enough to continue. And he's 27 seconds on crosswords with you, Tony, starting now.
I once annoyed a very good friend of mine, Andy Smart, by stealing his newspaper and filling in the crossword for...
Paul Merton challenge.
No, sorry, mistake. Crosswords are the subject.
The crosswords are the subject. He can repeat it. But, of course, if you interrupt somebody, and Clement Freud challenged...
He did repeat newspaper.
But it's too late now, Clement.
Only because my buzzer doesn't work.
Works magnificently. Your light comes on sometimes a little late, but I'm able to judge when you buzzed first, and I'm... you
can't
bluff
you
your way
when he's buzzed if the light comes on a little late? How do you do that? Some phenomenon?
I'm really just being
very loyal to the very excellent BBC engineers. They do a wonderful job. And
it's marvellous, I think. Yes, really? I think it's incredible that we can get people on the moon, and yet we can't get this damn buzzer to work. 2 weeks running.
Anyway, Tony Hawks, you had a correct challenge, and I don't know who challenged, actually. Was it Tony?
Paul challenged me when I was in beautiful flow because I repeated the word crossword, and he didn't realise.
Ah, that's
it,
right.
See?
Let's get back to see. That.
It's called short-term memory, Nicholas.
Tony, you have 19 seconds on crosswords, starting now.
I wrote the word bottom in every clue on his crossword. He was few...
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of clue.
Yes, you said clue before.
Quite some time earlier, though.
I know, it was right at the beginning, but I have to remember right back. I do a quick recall in the brain.
You didn't do so well a minute ago, did you?
I have to slip up occasionally for the sake of the fun of the show. I have to show
your fallibility isn't in question, I don't think.
So, 15 seconds are left, Paul, for you on crosswords starting now.
I remember once...
Clement Freud challenged.
Repetition of remember.
Yes, you've remembered too much. Clement, 13 seconds to tell us something about crosswords starting now.
Among the crosser words I know are damn, bum, hell, bother.
And a pause. Peter Jones.
I thought I'd better interrupt in case he went too far. Here's a family programme, you know.
And it was also hesitation. So
yes,
5 seconds for you, Peter, on crosswords starting now.
I know John Gielgud always does crosswords at the first reading of plays that he is in.
And Tony Hawk's challenge.
Was there some hesitation?
There was some hesitation, Tony. You cleverly got in. Half a second to go. Crosswords starting now.
Oh!
So a lot of points were scored in that round, but the situation is still that Paul Merton is in the lead ahead of Clement Freud, and then comes Tony Hawks and Peter. And, Paul, it's your turn to begin. The subject is fair. You can take that any way you like, you know, in just a minute, and you start now.
First Baron George Jeffreys had very fair hair. He was known as the Blondie Judge. Defendants would come in and say, come on then, show us your worst old white-haired devil. And he would. He would brush his locks back over his shoulder and condemn people to certain death. He used to catch their eyes with a little glint and just a little hint of Marilyn Monroe, perhaps, even though this was some 200 years before she was born. There was something in his manner that suggested...
Clement Freud challenge.
300 years before she was born.
1600, yes. 35 seconds are left for you, Clement, to tell us something about fare starting now.
Fares are usually collected by conductors on buses who go around saying, any more fares, please. And it is an extraordinary thing that we use three thank yous in the transaction of purchasing...
Tony Hawk's challenge.
Repetition of thank yous.
Three thank yous.
Yes.
Yes. It is a repetitious thought, a repetitious remark, but he was not repeating any words.
Okay.
So, well tried, Tony, but I'm afraid it was an incorrect challenge. Clement, another point in 19 seconds, fair, starting now.
One of the most entertaining things in the counties of England are the fairs, which are held usually in the summer, but quite often in autumn as well. It is a phenomenon which people from other countries enjoy greatly, and come to Britain for virtually no other reason than to buy gooseberry jam, sherry trifle.
This was to be the last round, so let me give you the final score. Peter Jones finished in fourth place, a little way behind Tony Hawks, who's not played the game before, did extremely well. Then came Clement Freud, and the one with the most points this week is the one we call our winner, and that is Paul Merton. Thank you very much indeed. It only remains for me to say, on behalf of the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, and Ling, who has been keeping the score, our producer, Sarah Smith, and, of course, our four talented panellists, Paul Merton, Clement Freud, Peter Jones, and Tony Hawks, and myself, Nicholas Parsons. Thank you for tuning in. We hope you enjoyed the show, and we'll want to tune in again same time next week when we take to the air and we play Just a Minute. Until then, from all of us here, goodbye. Thank you.
Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and once more it is my pleasure, as the minute waltz fades away, to introduce the four personalities who are going to play Just a Minute. Clement Freud, Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones, and Wendy Richard. Will you please welcome all four of them? Beside me sits Anne Ling, who keeps the score and also blows her whistle when the 60 seconds are up. And once more, I'm going to ask our four players of the game to speak on the subject that I give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject on the card. Clement Freud, will you begin the show this week? And the subject is advertising. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, if you can, starting now?
Advertising is something which is specifically prohibited in the British Broadcasting Corporation's charter, which was fashioned by Parliament sometime after the First World War. It is for this reason that I'm reluctant to talk glowingly about British Railways.
Wendy Richard, challenge.
Is that a second British there?
Yeah.
Yes, that's right. You repeated the word British. So the first point of the show goes to Wendy Richard for a correct challenge, and she takes over the subject of advertising. There are 42 seconds left, starting now.
The trouble is, when one comes to the Christmas period, there's far too much advertising of toys on television, and it's always aimed at the children, obviously, who then nag their parents into buying a lot of expensive doodahs and thingamabobs and what have you for them to open on.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Sort of hesitation building up.
Yes, I agree. And 23 seconds on advertising, Derek, starting now.
Advertising is an interesting subject. I remember somebody once said that doing business...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
He says it's an interesting subject. That surely remains to be seen.
I think he can make a personal opinion, Peter.
You think so?
Oh, yes. I mean, everybody does, always.
Well, he should make it after he's made the interesting remarks, surely.
I don't think it really matters. You've
no,
got to keep
I know,
going
it doesn't
somewhere.
Matter. No. I'm just trying to keep the game going, you know.
An incorrect challenge, Peter. You're trying very hard this week. I'm delighted to see it. Derek has an incorrect challenge, so he gets a point for that, of course. 19 seconds are left to tell us something about advertising, starting now.
Doing business without advertising is rather like winking at a girl in the dark. You know what you're doing, but nobody else does. So I think it's terribly important to advertise as much as you possibly can, whatever your wares might be. I once ran rock and roll concerts, and I used to wander around the streets with an alligator's head on.
Well, that whistle tells us that 60 seconds are up, and whoever is speaking that moment gains an extra point. And it was Derek Nimmo who has, of course, taken the lead at the end of the round. Wendy, it is your turn to begin. The subject, pratfalls. Will you tell us? I don't know why you lie. Sounds disgusting, but it isn't, actually. And Wendy might tell us something about it as she begins now.
In my humble opinion, the master of all pratfalls was Dickie Henderson. When you saw him do his act, when he was sitting in the bar, you know, it's 3:15, there's no one in the place except you and me, and then he does this pratfall as he leaves. He was the best. Mind you, in the new series of Grace and Favour, Molly Sugden does a brilliant pratfall when we're in the courtroom. She goes down like a tree being felled. It really is a wonderful sight to behold.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Repetition of wonderful.
Derek, you have a point for a correct challenge in 31 seconds to talk on pratfalls, starting now.
40 miles north of Christchurch, on the South Island of New Zealand, are the Pratt Falls. Edmund Pratt went out to Timaru in 1861, the original Canterbury settlers there, and on the Rakaia River, he found and discovered the falls that now bear his name. I went salmon fishing there last year and caught a 16.5-pounder, which gave me tremendous pleasure. He didn't live very long after that because he became a convert of Bishop Selwyn, who was going around preaching to the Maoris. And Pratt,
Peter Jones has challenged.
He's got a long way from Pratt Falls.
Yes, he's going on about
the bishop and
the chap himself.
Pratt Falls, I'm talking about, and the Rakaia River.
I know, very well-known Pratt Falls. Yeah. We all know them, of course. You're going on postcards. About...
about the fellow Pratt.
God knows, I was brought up on the Pratt Falls, frankly. Very familiar.
You've got on to deviate onto the fellow Pratt, and Peter Jones had got him with 4 seconds to go on Pratt Falls, starting now.
I thought they were in the Blue Mountains, just outside Sydney in New South Wales.
Peter, you were speaking as the Whistle Wind, got another point, and you're equal with Wendy Richard in third place, then Clement Freud and Derek Nimmo, 1 point ahead in the lead. Derek, your turn to begin the subject, facts. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
I suppose you mean by facts the abbreviation of facsimile, which is the way of transmitting by a telephone wire information around the world. You can actually reproduce instantly in Jakarta that which you are feeding into your machine in London. It was invented originally by the Japanese because, of course, their language being comprised of pictograms, or they couldn't actually send them by telex. So they had to find a new form of sending these letters around the world.
Wendy, Richard,
we had a lot of sendings there.
Yes, we did have a repetition of sendings. So, Wendy, you have 32 seconds to tell us something about fax, starting now.
I have a fax machine, which I find extremely useful. It's one way of communicating very quickly and cheaper to use than a telephone. My... what?
Wendy Clement, Roy Challenge.
Not.
Hmm? What?
Not. Same price.
It's cheaper to send a fax because it takes longer to say something, whereas you can put that bit of paper through quicker than speaking to somebody over a phone.
I mean, it's a question of judgment. I mean, you might put something more briefly on a piece of paper than you would if you chatted on the phone.
You're not counting the time writing the letter to start with, are you?
No, Wendy, I take your point, because if you talk on the phone, you'll probably chatter away and spend longer
on
the phone.
No, I don't.
I'm supporting you.
Oh, thank you.
I'm supporting you. For goodness sake, agree with me, because I'm not going to agree with Clement and let you keep the subject. 23 seconds to tell us more about facts, starting now.
Billy Burton has a wonderful line in Grace and Favour, where he comes into the main hall...
Derek Nimmo Chan.
Is she going to keep on plugging this show?
It's no worse than you going on with your place dropping.
Incorrect challenge, Wendy. 18 seconds on facts, starting now.
Where he comes in and he has to say, facts is facts and that's a facts. And I thought that was absolutely marvellous. And fortunately, so did most of the audience.
Peter Jones challenge.
I don't think she ought to give any more quotes. Might damage the show, you see.
So what is your challenge, Peter?
Well, advertising in a sort of negative way.
Well tried, Peter. Wendy, you have another point. 8 seconds, facts, starting now.
I don't know where I would be without my facts. It is so...
Peter Jones, your challenge.
In exactly the same place.
Because you started off before saying, I don't know where I'd be without my facts.
Yes,
you did.
Repetition, you see.
Repetition, yes. So, Peter, you've got 4 seconds.
Really should listen
tell
to
us
what
something
I'm
about
saying.
Facts starting now.
They will never replace the old-fashioned telegram. That's what I miss, particularly when they used to appear in a play. One open.
I agree with you, Peter. There was something rather exciting about a telegram. You have moved forward with that extra point. You're 9 second place. Clement, we're back with you to begin, and the subject is the video. Would you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
I don't know about the video, but a video is a sort of thing that you stick into a toast rack placed under a machine, which shows television pictures, and if you press the right buttons, there's no reason in the world why the program which you intended to tape doesn't come out, provided you put your thumb onto the point on the dial.
Peter Jones.
Well...
you've come to his rescue, really, haven't you?
Yes, I did, really.
Yes.
It seemed as though we were heading for a terminal hesitation.
He Peter, yes, hesitation. 34 seconds are left for you to tell us something about the video starting now.
When I went out at the beginning of this show for a few minutes, I went to telephone my wife to ask her to put the video on at 10 o'clock because I might not be home in time, and I'm actually taking part in a programme that's going to appear at that hour.
Derek Nimmo, chance.
Hesitation.
What?
Was that hesitation?
Was it? Yes, there was a hesitation.
You heard it as well?
I heard it, yes.
But you must have been right then.
Well, I think you tried to remember what the programme was you were in and you hesitated.
I didn't want to advertise, you see.
That was it, yes. Derek, was a correct challenge, so we have 17 seconds to tell us something about the video starting now.
Talking about video, President Bush, when in Australia recently, actually in Melbourne, said the only button he had his finger on now was the video, meaning that he was no longer had on the atomic bomb. That was rather a relief, I thought, except knowing how inadequate I am with the video, I thought I might blow the whole thing up if I had my finger on that of...
Oh, no! I'm afraid... Clement challenged just before the whistle went.
What repetition of finger.
Yes, you had your finger out just a bit too often there. I mean, and we got in with half a second to go on the video, Clement, starting now. So Clement managed to get in just before the whistle, gained an extra point for doing that. He and Derek Nimmo equal in second place. They're both 1 point behind Wendy Richard and Peter Jones, who are in the lead together. Peter, your turn to begin. The subject, exercise. Tell us something about it, if you can, in this game, starting now.
Well, I do try to do a bit. It isn't something that comes to me very naturally. I need an incentive, some objective, like going to buy something or visit a person. Animals don't exercise because they need it. They just are looking after something. For instance, greyhounds run after an electric hare. Now, I dare say, if a mechanical machine could be arranged with Wendy Richard on it, I could...
Wendy challenged before she went on to that machine.
Bit of a hesitation.
Well, it was getting to the exciting part, actually.
Yes, and then you hesitated, Peter. So yes, I agree with Wendy's challenge. 35 seconds, Wendy, for you to tell us about exercise starting now.
Exercise is good for us all, whether we like it or not. Having just moved to a house, I find I get enough exercise running up and down the stairs. Plus, I have to walk a lot now because I have a pet. I also go to a gym to exercise. It's good for you as far as... What?
Clement Freud, chance.
Two goods.
You're too good. Yes, you see, exercise is good for you. You said right at the beginning.
Oh, dear.
And now you said good again. So, Clement, you have 9 seconds to tell us something about exercise starting now.
Exercise is an extraordinarily profitable industry, and there are now in the cities and towns of this country an increasing number of gymnasia which open for the...
So, Clement Freud speaking as the whistle went, has moved forward, and he's now equal with Wendy Richard in the lead, but Peter Jones and Derek Nimmo are not far behind. And Wendy, it's your turn to begin, so I'm going to give you the subject of an odd pet. And you have 60 seconds starting now.
Those of you who've heard me on this programme before will know that I go on about little Henry, my pet cockatiel. Well, she is an odd pet. But now I have another odd pet, because last April I acquired a lovely little Cairn Terrier whom I have called Shirley Brahms. Now, you might say there is not an odd pet about a dog.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
A hesitation.
There was a hesitation, yes. So 36 seconds are left. Derek, can you tell us about an odd pet starting now?
1955, I was road manager to Al Martino and Petula Clark.
Peter Jones challenge.
I didn't hear that. Did you say you were romancing with Al Martino?
I said I was road manager to Al Martin. I was trying to get a bit of sort of action, moving it along, a bit of speed.
Well, you moved it so much, nobody heard what the word you said. So what was your challenge, Peter?
Oh, I'm embarrassed now. I don't want to embarrass Derek. His personal life is his own affair, I mean. Don't want to drag it out.
So we won't charge any points on that. And Derek, you have 32 seconds to continue. An odd pet starting now.
Petula Clark had at that time just been in the Huggets with Catherine Harrison, who is 100 years old on the 25th of February 1992. But she was rather an odd pet. She had even then these
tremendous Francophile leanings, and it was no surprise to me when soon afterwards she married a frog and went to live in Paris, or as we'll have to call it soon, Paris, if the European commissioners have their way. But another odd pet I know of is a boa constrictor, which is 12 feet long and...
So Derek kept going till the whistle wind gained another point for doing so, and he's now equal with Clement Freud and Wendy Richard in the lead. Derek, it's your turn to begin. The subject is censorship. Will you tell us something about that in this game starting now?
Well, I don't really like censorship. It is quite extraordinary that the attempt...
Wendy Richard challenge.
That was a hesitation.
No, no, not quite, Wendy. No, he hadn't really got going, and there was only 5 seconds there. So, Derek, I don't agree with the challenge, so you have 55 seconds to continue with censorship starting now.
The attempt to muzzle some rascal has actually...
Wendy, challenge.
He did have hesitation.
Well, that was hesitation then, definitely. Yes, yes, he swallowed it. So, Wendy, 50 seconds are left, and you have censorship starting now.
I do believe in censorship in some respects. I think it's important that when it comes to certain magazines or newspapers that are of the lower standards, then there should be censorship. In fact, they should be taken off the streets altogether. But...
It's a Jones challenge.
That was a bit of a hesitation.
Hesitation was a complete full stop.
Oh, it was, yes. Yeah, well, I
think they were all amazed at what you were going to say next. They were going to wait for it, and she didn't even know herself.
So bring back the birch, I thought.
There are 26 seconds left for you, Peter Jones, to tell us something about censorship as you see it starting now.
Well, of course, I don't believe there should be any censorship at all unless you could find exactly the right person to be the censor. Now, modesty forbids me...
Clement Freud challenged.
I agree with Peter Jones.
So what is your challenge within the rules of just a minute?
Nothing. I think he deserves a point.
See how generous they can be on occasions. Yes, because you were interrupted, Peter, you do get a point for that. And you continue with censorship, and 18 seconds left starting now.
Because I think I could be a wonderful censor. Ship.
I said censor before.
Clement challenged again.
I think he'd be a very good censor.
Yes. What is your challenge? You agree again?
Yep.
You're not going to have him for hesitation on the ship?
Oh, no.
So he's given you another point.
Well, that's very good.
13 seconds are left for you to carry on in this way about censorship. Peter, starting now.
I should enjoy seeing a lot of the films that people argue about and some people want banned. And I think the idea of censoring television would be particularly interesting because, of course...
Derek, Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of interesting.
Yes, you did say things about were interesting before,
fatal.
Peter.
Yes,
yes, yes. Derek got in with 1 second to go on censorship, starting now.
The Lord Chamberlain had to censor all plays.
Well, Derek Nimmo was speaking as the whistle went and got an extra point and others in the round, so he's now in the lead. Oh, it's terribly interesting. He's one ahead of Peter Jones, who's one ahead of Wendy Richard, who's one ahead of Clement Freud. Clement Freud, your turn to begin. The subject, grounds. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
In the county town of March in Cambridgeshire, there is an estate agent called Grounds, to whom I went when I was elected a parliamentary prospective candidate, and said, please would you find me an office because I wish to represent the Liberal Party. And he said, no trouble at all. And I went back to him 3 or 4 times without success before somebody told me that he was the president of the Conservative Party, which is why it took me such a very long time to find anywhere from which place to operate. Grounds for divorce are commonly...
Derek, you challenged.
Well, he just stopped.
He just stopped. He doesn't have any grounds for divorce, which is very apt. So 21 seconds for you to tell us something about grounds, Derek, starting now.
Non-consummation of the marriage might certainly be grounds for divorce, as...
Clement Freud challenged.
It's a ground for divorce, not grounds.
I think, actually...
Well, if it only happened once, I suppose.
Then it would be confirmation, Peter. So I give you the benefit of the doubt on this one, Derek, and tell you to continue on grounds for 15 seconds, starting now.
The Melbourne cricket ground is the largest oval that I've seen in the southern hemisphere, or indeed in the northern one as well. I've been there on many occasions and would particularly like to be there for the one-day series, which is about...
Wendy Richard challenge.
You said there twice.
That's a mean challenge, but he's correct. All right, Wendy, you've cleverly got in with 2 seconds to go on grounds, starting now.
I've been to Sydney Cricket Ground, and I've...
So, they're all very close still. Peter, your turn to begin. The subject, limelight. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Well, that was the old-fashioned kind of stage lighting that required a lime-filled tin or cylinder of metal, which was heated to a high degree and gave a flood of very white light on the stage. Now it's used as a metaphor for seeking publicity and trying to get into the centre of things and generally having an ego trip, if you can possibly arrange it, like getting your name in the newspapers, the headlines, for instance. That would, I suppose, count as being in the limelight. And I don't know how many people here have actually ever had the experience of being in a floodlit stage, or on one, and having the audience staring at you, and you feel that it's really too much to bear.
Oh, Derek, yes.
Well,
No, it's only 7 seconds to go. No, 5 seconds to go. Oh, you almost
well,
made
yeah,
it. Because last week Peter Jones kept going for 60 seconds. In fact, he went for 75 seconds. So.
Well, you could count that 15 seconds extra.
I don't know if it was actually last week, but it was one of the shows. You got in quite correctly, Derek, so I've got to be fair within the game. 5 seconds left for Limelight with you, Derek, starting
in now. In Sydney Cricket Ground, Wendy Richards, standing in the middle of the oval, was in the limelight, and gosh, she told about Grace Mullins and all the wonderful series that she's done.
Right, so now in the lead is Derek Nimmo, ahead of Wendy Richard, and then Peter Jones and Clement Freud in that order. And Wendy, your turn to begin. The subject, my name. Can you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
My name was invented by J.M. Barrie, who wrote Peter Pan and Wendy. My mother gave me my name because that was her favourite tale. Also, you cannot shorten my name. If my mother... Oh, no.
When Clement Freud sings. Yeah?
Repetition of mother.
Yes.
Yes, yes. And you can shorten it to when. 43 seconds on F.U. Clement on my name, starting now.
When I was born, I understand that there was some discussion as to what should be my name, and among suggestions were Alexander, Bernard, Clement, David, Edgar, Frederick, George, Harry, Ivor, James, Kenneth... Leonard.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Well, he's listing again, as he
did
That's
a very
few
observant
weeks ago.
Of you, Peter, yes.
Well, I thought I'd let him get going, give him a chance, you know, but it was I felt it was over the top. But,
but
that's a different game altogether.
It's not one of the rules of just a minute.
No.
You can
but
have lists if you want to.
And you can.
So it was an incorrect challenge. I'm sorry, Peter.
Yes.
I don't know he's going to continue with the list, but he has 25 seconds left to say something about my name, starting
being boring.
Other names were considered, amongst them Leonard, Martin, Norman, Oliver, Peter.
You did have Leonard before, I'm afraid.
He interrupted me on Leonard.
He may have interrupted, but if you say it previously...
No, that's what he buzzed on.
Clement, you have the benefit of the doubt. And you have another point for an incorrect challenge. And you have 22 seconds. My name, starting now.
Oliver, Peter, Quentin, Richard, Sylvester, Thomas, Victor, Wenceslas, Xavier, Eve, and Zarathustra.
There ain't no challenge.
I think you've been called Eve. That would have been deviation.
would have been deviation, but...
why?
They could have considered it, couldn't they? So give Derek a bonus point for enjoying the challenge, a point to Clement because he was interrupted, and he still keeps going with 9 seconds on my name, starting now.
Every year, newspapers tend to publish the most popular and unpopular names that have been listed in the birth columns thereof. And it is...
Well, Clement Freud, who was in fourth place with all that list of names, has leapt forward into second place behind Derek Nimmo, who's still in the lead. We have time for one more round. Sensationalism, that is the subject. Clement, it's your turn to begin. Can you tell us something about sensationalism starting now?
Sensationalism is rather a good long word with which to begin the last round of Just a Minute. It could be manifested, for instance, by walking onto a stage wearing no underwear and expecting the sort of audience reaction which sensationalism nearly always attracts. People gaping, opening their mouths, stretching their eyes, tightening their teeth, looking for all the world as if what you had done was unique and had never before been attempted.
Wendy, Richard, challenge.
How would they know you haven't got any underwear?
They'd look. You'd be wearing a kilt.
Well, you didn't make that clear in the beginning. I mean, like, you can walk on wearing a suit and not have any ninnies or anything on underneath, and nobody would know.
Well, I thought he hadn't got any underwear or any trousers on, this character, and that's why it was sensational.
I think he exaggerated the effect that it would have on the audience.
In today's permissive age, you're probably right, Peter. Yes,
yes.
Or do you think it's the individual concern?
Clement, you mean?
Yes.
Well, no, I mean, I think if you go on stark naked, there wouldn't be that much of a...
Clement, I disagree with the challenge, so you have 26 seconds to continue on sensationalism starting now.
Many newspapers use sensationalism simply to sell copies and are ever boring the issue which they report. Thanks to the way that it is treated by the reporters and their editors, it comes out as if it were compulsive sensationalism. For instance, quite a small fire in a back street in Kensington near Derek Nimmo's home would get the headlines in the Sun on the grounds that famous actor...
What would your headline be, Clement? Famous actor?
The whistle went.
Oh. You're going to deprive us of that. Well, a very interesting result. In fourth place was Peter Jones. He was only 3 points behind Wendy Richard. And Derek Nimmo and Clement Freud finished up with the equal number of points. So we declare them both the joint winners. It's sad for me to have to say that this is the last programme in this present series of Just a Minute, but I... Ah, yes. Well, we all feel the same. We hope to be back doing another series, and until then, it only remains for me to say on the four excellent players of the game today, Wendy Richard, Clement Freud, Peter Jones and Derek Nimmo, and also thank Anne Ling for keeping the time so well and blowing her whistle so magnificently, Ian Messiter for creating the game and keeping us all in employment, and Sarah Smith for so beautifully directing and editing the programme. And from me, Nicholas Parsons, it's goodbye to the next series. Until then, thank you very much for listening. Bye-bye.